Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Afternoon Tune. I'm your host, Josh, and with me is my co-host here.
Hello there, it's Nick.
And we got a nice special guest, Kasim, is with us today. He's helping us out. We're going to be doing an MCU tier list. We're going to be ranking all the MCU movies. We're going to adjust it to when the Spider-Man movie comes out in December. So this is just, I've never done a tier list of the MCU movies before, so this is my first one. So it'd be nice to rank all the movies, you know, just put up on a nice little list. I've never done that. Have you ever done that, Nick?
I think I've done it a couple times. It's never been on the record, though.
Okay, so it's official now. So this is on the record. This is official.
Yes, yes.
Official list. So this is an MCU tier list. Sometimes you'll see people do the tier list, you know, by themselves. This is a committee tier list. So we'll try to combine our three brains together, make the ultimate definitive MCU tier list there. Also,
yes, the one.
Yeah, let's go.
The Unimind, as Faustus called it in Internals. So next on the docket, we also got Dexter, New Blood. The new season of Dexter is out, premiered on Showtime. So the continuation of the Dexter series.
Yep. Showtime basically came together, as did Clyde Phillips, the original showrunner. He said, "Yo, those last four seasons were trash. I cannot go down like this."
Yeah, so we're going to be seeing what's going on in the new season of Dexter. Michael C. Hall returning as the titular character, everything like that. So we're going to be checking that out, seeing how that is, if it can return to its old glory of Dexter. Also, Big Mouth season 5. Nick is going to be talking about that. He watched that. That is back out. Also, Cowboy Bebop, going to be getting into some anime. I revisited the anime after many, many years. I haven't seen the anime since I was a teenager. I haven't seen the anime since I was like maybe 15, 16. So I rewatched the anime, the movie, in preparation for the live action series. It's going to come out in, I think, a couple of weeks. It's going to come out.
I think it's either this week or next week.
Yeah, so in preparation for that, I rewatched the Cowboy Bebop anime and rewatched the movie. So check that out. So I'm going to be eager to talk about that. So how's everybody doing? How's everybody going?
I'm doing good, man. I just had a little date night with my girl last night, so that's fun.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah,
and just hanging out with the doggo as always.
Yeah, I saw that. Saw
yeah,
some
this
pictures.
Is our fourth co-host here.
Oh yes, hey. Bubbles. You know, you can always put the Bubbles emote in the chat on the Twitch chat. We got the nice little cute little Bubbles emote. Actually,
do the Bubbles paw of approval whenever on one of our lists.
Yeah. Let me. Oh, let me switch it to more of the Bubbles here, because the symbol was kind of blocking it there. Yeah. Yeah, so yeah, see little cute little Bubbles there, so you can do the Bubbles emote that we have there from Jenny Liano that she made for us. Very nice of her to do. You know, I can always get you in contact with Jenny Liano for her to do other, like, Twitch emotes, art. Very great artist she is, other artwork, so she's fantastic. She does the Nunas podcast, which is on YouTube, which has the first 10 episodes of the show that they just put on YouTube now. So you go type that in.
Sweet.
They do K-pop. You know, stories, K-pop, entertainment news. They do also album reviews of different K-pop artists. So that's very, very nice. Nunas, Noonas podcast. Go check that out. Very, very good. So Kasim, we got him here. Tell a little, the crowd about yourself, how you know Nick, background, stuff like that, you know, just let people know who you are.
Excellent. My name is Kasim Ruffin. I'm a 2-0 professional mixed martial artist. About to be 3-0 January 15th, 3 days after the birthday. I'm going to knock a boy out.
Hell yeah.
Okay.
Mr. Mac time. I love Marvel, man. I love comics, and I love manga also. But comics was that thing that, you know, made a person, well, me specifically, feel welcome in a way, I guess you could say. So.
Okay.
An absolute blessing. It's made the thing that I love in seclusion as a kid popularized, you know?
Yeah. So since you're into manga, that type of stuff, have you read Cowboy Bebop? Have you seen Cowboy Bebop, buddy?
Oh, without a doubt, I love Cowboy Bebop. Part of me was actually kind of sad that, you know, the old dream of having Keanu Reeves play Spike, isn't gonna happen. I like the guy that got playing.
Okay. All right. So yeah, we'll talk about that. Be interesting to get your thoughts on that, everything like that. So, you know, you said, you know, you kind of growing up, comics was that thing that kind of inspired you in a way. So growing up, were you kind of like scrawny kid a little bit picked on, or, you know, then like when you got older, you're like, okay, I'll channel that aggression into knocking people out, or what?
No, man. Well, I was scrawny, but I was mainly sickly, just a skinny, sick kid, you know, asthma pretty bad. I always wanted to be around my older and bigger cousins, so I broke a lot of bones and sprung a lot of stuff because, you know, I was the little runt of the litter.
Oh, okay.
Ironically, the reason I got into MMA is because of wrestling. I wanted to do martial arts, but we didn't quite have the cha-ching for it. And then I realized that, oh, snap, wrestling is a martial art, and it's in school, so it's a free martial art.
And it's free.
Hey.
Oh, okay.
Awesome wrestling coach. I ended up meeting our tutor, name was Jerry, and he introduced me to Xavier, and now I'm punching people and having a blast doing it.
Oh, that's pretty good, man. Well, I'll be rooting for you. I'll be supporting you. Do you have any merch yet? Any things like that?
So right now I have t-shirts and everything out. They're really dope. And with MMA Tea Company. So if you hit up MMA Tea Company and just look for that Caution Kasim shirt, you'll find it. It has like this awesome wolf signia. It's spectacular. I actually got my neck on it. Keep everything in it.
Okay. So yeah, afterwards we get your details. I'll be putting that information in the description below when I upload the video. And I'll make sure to get me, cop me a tee and wear it on the next show. Most definitely. So I'll be
rocking that shit too.
Yeah. I'll be definitely rocking that, everything like that. Nick just had to go get the door real quick for his place right there. But yeah, man, it's a pleasure meeting you. Pleasure having you on. I'm glad Nick invited you. Glad to have somebody else on the show to talk about this MCU tier list, man.
So I'm ready. Let's get it started.
All right. So let me just go to the website here. Let me go pick it out, and we could go just down the line and basically, yeah, put them in order here. So let me just make sure this is the nice, proper, updated one that has like the Eternals on it as well.
And are we including the TV shows? Are we including all the stuff in Disney Plus too?
Do you want to do that? That's also another big one. I feel like that's very challenging to include the TV shows plus the movies. Do you want to do that?
I think you can ignore stuff like Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and Inhumans. Well, as you should. But I feel like with the Disney Plus shows, you kind of have to because they're so in the same universe. They're so closely tied to the MCU.
Okay.
So it's not Netflix and Hulu where the shows would make mention of the movie, but the movie would never really make mention of any events in the shows.
I think at the time those were coming out, they were like two completely separate departments that were handling the shows. Like, Netflix was basically being run by Jeff Loeb and Ike Perlmutter, and Kevin Feige would always just be like, would listen to their ideas, and then Iron Fist came out, and he said, fuck out my office.
Okay. So you want to include...
Yeah, Mickey not having it. Uh-huh. Mickey Mouse was not having that shit. Fuck out my office!
Okay, so you want to do that plus the Disney Plus shows.
Okay, yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Let's do it.
All right, so let me just find the right list here. Just make sure this one has Eternals on it, because that's the new updated one. So let me just make sure this one has it real quick. All right. Hold on just a second. Okay, I think this is the one right here. Yeah, this is the one. Okay, here we go. This is also includes like all the other stuff as well, so just ignore that, but this basically is all the stuff that we need to be having right here for it. So what's the rankings you want to do? You want to do S tier is the highest one, and then what are the other rankings kind of you want to have here?
Let's see. I think like a S to probably like a I'd say for me, the lowest that an MCU thing goes is probably like around a C, but just add a D just in case.
Okay, so we'll have a D as the last one here. And then in between, it's like, okay, like I'll put like D, S, and then A, then B, and then C. Do that.
Okay. Nice and simple.
Yeah, so we'll just do that as the last one. All right. Okay, here we go. So let me put it on screen for everyone to see here, just in case.
For everybody on the Twitch stream, twitch.tv/afternoontune.
Let's check this out. So we're going to go in order of all when the movies were released. So that's how we're going to be doing it. So the first one, Iron Man. Where would you put Iron Man?
Oof. To me, because I think that's the one that kind of started it all. Without Iron Man, you don't get stuff like Loki, like the Eternals, like Shang-Chi. And purely off of that legacy, I think it's an S-tier film. Also because for a movie that essentially doesn't have a script, it is so tightly, its narrative is so tight. You have Robert Downey Jr. giving a career-saving performance and basically setting up the blueprint for, hey, this is, we are actually going to do an entire shared universe of movies. And if you told like a 25-year-old me opening night of Avengers Endgame that I was going to see like Captain America wield Thor's hammer, I would have slapped you.
All right. So you're going to give it S tier.
Mm.
I have to agree with that S tier. Ironically, I only think it's actually like a B-level movie, C-level movie, but because of the nostalgia, when it started, I'm going to have to go with S tier.
Yeah, same. And I can't even count how many times I've rewatched the movie, and I still get chills every time it's like that initial suit-up scene. Mm-hmm. I still get chills every time I rewatch it.
Mm. Okay. I would have to agree. I would say, yeah, it's the thing that started it all. And a lot of that movie really was Robert Downey Jr., John Favreau flying at the seat of their pants, you know what I mean? Just kind of a lot of that just relied on, you know, his personality and just kind of like the ad-libbing and everything like that. And it spawned
this great thing. Yeah, because that movie, they didn't have a script. They had like a very basic outline of all the stuff that would happen in the story. And then it would basically be up to Robert Downey Jr. and the cast to improvise their way to finished movie.
Yeah. So yeah, I would have to go with that one personally. So yeah, so we're going to move that one into S tier. So S tier for me is the really great movies of the MCU. Like I think, you know, the really kind of great ones personally. And then A for me would be considered, I think, really good. And then B would be good. And C would be kind of in between. D would be just fairly mediocre. So for me, yeah, S tier for me with the first Iron Man. Okay, let's see. Next up is The Incredible Hulk with Edward Norton here. Where would you rank this one?
Yeah, it's kind of a B-tier movie for me. This it feels the most disconnected from the MCU up until this point. And honestly, I think the movie moves too fast, and it kind of illustrates what's common critique with the MCU is it has a villain problem, and especially it's no more apparent than in that movie.
Mm. So you said D, you said?
I said B tier.
B tier. Okay.
I said D.
Oh, you said D.
Okay. I said D.
D. And why would you say D there?
It's a boring movie. Like, I would love to see the Hulk go out in Hulk mode, but it gave us nothing extra. One of the reasons, in my opinion, why the MCU is so good is because, Captain America, right? It's not a hero / spy movie. It's a spy movie where you happen to throw heroes into the mix.
Mm.
The Hulk is just, I don't know, the movie's boring. I'd rather watch Lou Ferrigno.
Okay.
And I kind of agree with you that that movie probably has the biggest pacing issues out of all of the MCU movies. And I think a lot of that is owed to a lot of Edward Norton's interference with the script. Because I think he basically rewrote like 75% of the movie.
Mm. Yeah, I think a lot of his changes were for the better. You know, him trying to include more dramatic stuff, you know, more personal stuff. And I think there's even a scene that got cut because he wanted to have the scene where Hulk tried to kill himself in the movie, but they took that out. They took that out. So, yeah, you know, he tried to do a lot more with that movie, try to bring a lot more to it. I guess eventually it got him kicked off because his ass didn't come back for Avengers.
The mouse and Feige said, oh, this motherfucker's back. Mark Ruffalo, what's up, man?
Yeah. Let's see. So Kasim, he's at a D. Nick is at a B. I'm somewhere in between. I think it's between a C or a D myself. I would personally go with maybe a D. So I'm going to agree with Kasim there, personally.
All right. It's on the lower end of Marvel movies for me, but I still think it's one that there are elements here there that I enjoy.
Yeah, so but, I'll go with a D myself here. So we're gonna put it a D here. All right, so moving on from Incredible Hulk. After Incredible Hulk was Iron Man 2. So Iron Man 2, what were your feelings about this movie?
Honestly, I'd say this is probably my least favorite MCU movie. This is a very strong D for me.
Kasim?
I gotta go to C, right? And it was just because memories with this movie, like we laughed a lot at this movie. Mickey Rourke, I mean, he did his thing. It was fun. It was a C. I think it could have been a good movie, but
I think the movie, it got distracted from by just a virtue of the fact that this is basically a 2.5 hour commercial for the Avengers. It kind of forgot to tell Tony Stark's story in the film instead.
I feel kind of the same way. There was a lot of trying to throw in other stuff. Very much suffered from, you know, what people call sequelitis. A lot of just too much shit going on, trying to set up all this other different stuff. Didn't really work. Mickey Rourke as a villain, weak villain, really waste of Sam Rockwell, who's an amazing actor, as Justin Hammer. He's a character I wish would come back in the MCU and they would do something better with him. I think he's a, you know, really terrific actor if you've seen any of his work.
Yeah, if you've seen stuff like Three Billboards Outside Ebbing, Missouri, he's incredible. That stuff like Mr. Right, which is a very fun action comedy with him and Anna Kendrick, or basically just anything with Sam Rockwell.
Yeah. Yeah, so yeah, he's amazing, but in that they try to treat it as like Justin Hammer is the evil Tony Stark, but he's so incompetent that you can't even believe that he is, you know, supposed to be a, you know, like the someone who is a comparable to Tony Stark because he's such an idiot.
Yeah, so he's basically just real life Elon Musk.
Yeah, who was in the movie? He made a cameo. I forget. Yeah, he made a cameo in Iron Man 2 in the dinner scene. Him and his toupee. So that's really nice. For me, Iron Man 2. I would go with a D myself. I would agree with Nick. I'm going with a D. There's some good elements. They try to do the demon in the bottle storyline. They fail at doing that.
They do it as much as Disney would allow them to do it.
Yeah. So for me, I'd go D. Personally, that's Iron Man 2.
You don't touch demon in the bottle is one of them.
Yeah.
Gonna dive into that, leave it alone.
Unless you're gonna go all in with that story, you should just not do it.
Next up is Thor. Where are you placing Thor?
Thor, I'd say it's a solid C. It was kind of the first one that had a very well-developed villain with Tom Hiddleston's Loki, and definitely a star-making, iconic performance from both him and Chris Hemsworth. But I think the movie, it takes away its most interesting elements, that being Asgard in the world that is set up there, and throws it away just to hang out with Thor on Earth.
Case?
Not much saying that movie was solid C. The best part of Thor 1 was Tom Hiddleston.
I think Thor 1 is solid. It's a solid origin movie. Chris Hemsworth, I mean, you know, I think he's fine. You know, first performance is Thor. They were trying to, Kenneth Branagh directed it. They were trying to do the whole Shakespeare thing. Comes off as kind of dull.
They were going for, like, this very high art, Shakespearean-esque aesthetic with the later movies, especially with something like Thor Ragnarok, it showed that was a mistake to put a guy like Chris Hemsworth in those shoes.
Yeah, it, you know, as recent times have shown, Chris Hemsworth has got a great talent for comedy. He's a natural comedic talent, and he does very good with it. Yeah, Tom Hiddleston introduced Loki, very good villain, one of the first good villains of the MCU. Anthony Hopkins as Odin does a very good job. You know, he's very solid. He gives that gravitas, that mm-hmm. natural power to the film. Natalie Portman, you know, she complained that they didn't really do much with her character. That and also Thor 2.
Which is completely a completely valid point.
Yes.
She's basically just tripping over herself to lay her hands on Chris Hemsworth's abs, which, to be fair.
Yeah. Hold on just a second. Hold on. Hold on. Just get somebody real quick. Okay. So, yep. All right. So, me personally, I'd put Thor as a D, but since you two guys, you said C, it's going to be a C. So, we're going to move Thor to C, and we're going to do that. Me personally, but got outvoted there. But yeah, so we're gonna go see. All right. Next up is Captain America and the First Avenger. See?
Yeah, this is A tier Marvel for me. This with Captain America, the biggest thing you have to worry about is you have to get your audience to like Steve Rogers as a character before he even touches the Super Soldier Serum. And that's something that this movie does really well. And Chris Hemsworth, a lot of people, I think, write him off as just kind of this, like, tall, handsome, pretty boy actor. And the man has chops and range, especially in the latter half of his career with stuff like Defending Jacob, where he's... I think he got passed over for the Emmys.
Hmm. Okay. Kasim.
All right. Well, we literally had just come off of seeing him play a perfect Johnny Storm.
Hmm.
Flipped over to play a perfect Steve Rogers.
Yeah. It's
by him in the role of Captain America when you think of people like. What's my man's name? I'm drawing a complete blank right now. That's crazy.
Because John Krasinski was up for the role. Chris Pratt auditioned.
The Batman from the same one when we had Mr. Freeze. I cannot think of his name right now. I'm so mad.
Chris O'Donnell?
No, he's going to be in a new Flash movie. They brought him back.
Oh, Michael Keaton.
Yes,
there we go. Oh, Michael Keaton, yeah.
Yeah. It puts him in those categories.
Yeah. So with me, with Captain America First Avenger, I think it's, you know, also very solid. I'd put it C myself. Love Chris Hemsworth. Chris Hemsworth. Sorry, it's all these damn Chrises. Holy shit.
Marvel did get three of the four Hollywood Chrises locked under contract.
That's very, very true. The only Chris that they're missing is Chris Pine. They got all the Chrises except Chris Pine, basically. I'm expecting him to come in eventually, and everything like that. So, with Captain America First Avenger, love Hayley Atwell. I think she's great in this. Always love to see her return. I think she's great as Peggy Carter. Loved her when she had her own show. They're even talking about doing Captain Carter since people liked her a lot as Captain Carter in the What If series. So I would love to see, you know, her return, and I think she's great. I think that Chris Evans, you know, as Captain America is really good, really brings that, you know, sense of Captain America out, you know, when he's the, you know, scrawny, sickly Captain America, Steve Rogers, before he gets the Super Soldier Serum, I think is also great. Dominic Cooper, who is Howard Stark, is also very good in the movie as well, who plays, what's his name, in the film? Tony Stark's father. What's his name?
Howard Stark. You literally just said it.
Oh, did I just say it? Oh, Jesus.
Yeah.
Oh, my bad. Yeah, I just said it. Oh, Jesus. My bad. Howard Stark. So I think he does a very good job. Tommy Lee Jones is also solid in the movie as well. Still very disturbing. He ate milk with steak, but okay, that's very disturbing.
Yeah.
And Viggo Mortensen here is the Red Skull.
That was Hugo Weaving.
I mean, damn, fucking hell. Hugo Weaving. Jesus Christ. The other guy from Lord of the Rings. So he does a very good job as Red Skull here. And even though I think he also was another person who said he kind of had a bad experience working with Marvel as well. Mm. But, you know, very solid film. I thought Joe Johnston's direction, making it makes sense to get him. He did The Rocketeer. It makes sense to kind of get him and everything like that.
That movie we talked about with Marvel going with different genres. Iron Man is more like the grounded sci-fi. Thor, it's magical fantasy elements. And Cap was more for those like 1940s serials aesthetic.
So that was a very nice choice. So I would say C myself. Nick, you said which place did you say? A, right?
I had it as an A tier movie.
And then Kasim, where did you have it as?
A.
A. So got outvoted here. I would have it as C myself. But since got outvoted, so we're gonna put Captain America at A here. Here we go. There it is. There's First Avenger. So we gotta move it up to A tier. All right. Next up is the Avengers. Now, where would you all place this?
I would say it's still a solid A. Whatever personal things you have about Joss Whedon aside. I still think the movie had kind of the impossible task of living up to, like, almost like at this point, like 4 years of expectations of taking all of these different franchises and putting them all together in one movie. And it ended up living up to those expectations in the best way possible.
Okay.
S tier. I think it's a C or B level movie, but it's S tier for the same reason I gave Iron Man S tier, because what it signaled was the beginning of a 10-year span with that Thanos little, that after credit scene right there. Boom. Phenomena.
Yeah, it set up the origin of one of the greatest movie villains of all time with Josh Brolin, eventually Josh Brolin's Thanos.
The Avengers, directed by Joss Whedon, I remember seeing it in theaters, being impressed, like, wow, they actually did it, right? They actually brought everybody together. They did all these separate movies. They brought in everybody. Looking back at it now and seeing how far they've come, it's crazy to go back and look at all these movies that are now over a decade old now. I mean, the first Iron Man came out in 2008. Now it's 2021 now. It's like crazy to think that.
Next year will be the 10th year anniversary of Marvel's The Avengers.
Yeah.
Which is insane to me.
Yeah, so that's just crazy that's been that long since they've done that. The Avengers, it kind of does have a very TV look to it. I mean, Joss Whedon directed it. He had come from the small screen. And, you know, at that time, you know, Joss Whedon was kind of a geek darling, you know, nerd darling. It's like, you know, him doing Buffy and Angel and all those other shows, Firefly.
Off the strength of Buffy, Angel, and Firefly. And I think this movie came out the same year as Woods, which he co-wrote.
Yeah. So... and that also starred Chris Hemsworth before people really knew he was going to be Chris Hemsworth Thor and everything like that. Because I think
pre Marvel workout and steroid plan. I mean diet.
you know what I mean. So you can't prove that. Can't prove in a court. You know that they do that. So I think it has. But it is still very cool. You know, a lot of moments. Love the circle shot. That's a great scene. They do the whole circle. They show everybody.
And an iconic shot that has been paid tribute to and parodied in countless other comic book properties, even in this franchise.
Yeah. I would give it an A myself. Nick, you said S. Kasim, you said S?
Yeah.
Okay. I said A tier also, but I see an argument for S tier, mostly just off of legacy of what this film set up.
Okay, so you're gonna go with S?
Yeah, I'll go with S because without the success of this movie, it was kind of every studio was looking at Marvel and Disney and saying that. I mean, come on, they're not really going to make an Avengers movie, are they? And yeah. Then they did, and it made all of the money in the world. Yeah. And it kind of kicked off this new era of Hollywood where every single studio was trying to get their cinematic universe.
Yeah, yeah. And nobody has competed. Everyone's failed. Yeah, nobody's. Nope. All right, so since I would put it A, but both guys said S, I could see S, so we're going to toss it in S. I'm going to test you guys. You know what movie's next?
Iron Man 3.
Iron Man 3. You don't already have it pulled up, do you?
Yeah, I have a list pulled up.
Oh, okay. Damn. Oh, that's no fun. Yeah, you got already list pulled up. All right. Iron Man 3. So what do you all think about Iron Man 3?
D. All right. Yeah, because you go ahead, because I may have a very controversial take on the movie. Considering the platform that we stream this on.
I give it a D, but I kind of want to put it as a C because the Mandarin was kind of funny. But the D to me, I didn't like it.
Okay.
Josh, what would you put it as?
For me, and I just had to put the video off screen there for a second because I just have to add this person real quick to the Discord. But yeah, for me, Iron Man 3, the more times I've gone back to it, I've actually liked it more, warmed up to it more. Before, I wasn't too big of a fan of it. You know, I didn't really like the whole Mandarin thing, but they did retcon it. I did understand what they were going for with it and everything like that. So it doesn't bother me as much anymore. And you know, Shane Black doing a superhero movie, I think is very awesome. You know, of course he worked very well with, Robert Downey Jr., in Kiss Kiss Bang Bang. If you've never seen Kiss Kiss Bang Bang, highly recommend you check out Kiss Kiss Bang Bang.
Yeah, Kiss Kiss Bang Bang is the movie that got Robert Downey Jr. Iron Man.
Pretty much, you know what I mean? So very, very much so. So, you know, I very much appreciate that. Now, this isn't Kiss Kiss Bang Bang Iron Man 3. It isn't as, I don't think, good as anything like that before. But it is still, I think, very, very good. For me, I would put Iron Man 3 in, I would say it's B or C myself. Mm. What about you, Nick?
All right. So here's my hot take. For me, this is my favorite Iron Man movie. I think this is the one that I think has the deepest story because you're dealing with a Tony Stark dealing with post-traumatic stress after the events of the Avengers, which is something that not a lot of superhero movies, let alone blockbusters, are willing to go to the level of that subject matter that they do. And it's something that was going for something heavier thematically, and I think Robert Downey and Shane Black nail it. I think the twist with Ben Kingsley's The Mandarin, the longer, I agree with you, Josh, the longer separation, the more times I've revisited the movie, the more times it actually works. Because politically, think about the time that this was going on, false flag operations were very much a thing in the news, and governments lying to people and people using figureheads to cover up terrorist actions. And that's something that really worked for me and still does to this day, especially after Ben Kingsley's comeback in something like Shang-Chi, and we've gotten the quote-unquote real Mandarin with Tony Leung.
And they do make a lot of jokes.
Okay, so maybe I just got to go back and rewatch it. It's fun.
Yeah. And things like that. So, So, Kasim, where would you kind of put it? Iron Man 3, you said.
So, originally I said D because, I don't know, I kind of waved at a C a bit because I thought the Mandarin, I thought it was funny. Well, Ben Kingsley was funny in it, but I'll go back and watch it. But for now, I'll be willing to give it a C.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. And then Nick, you said what was kind of score you gave it?
I was at an A tier for Iron Man 3.
A tier. I'm kind of at a B myself with Iron Man 3. I'd say a B myself.
We'll meet in the middle.
So B, put it at B.
B works for me.
Okay, so we're gonna put it at a B there. Okay. So let's see here. Let me pull up Iron Man 3, and let me move it over there. And what is next after Iron Man 3?
After Iron Man 3 is Thor: The Dark World. Universally considered the worst MCU movie. Well, at least was considered the worst movie in the MCU.
Yeah. Thor: The Dark World. Where would you guys place this?
I'm kind of at a D with this movie. Besides the return of Tom Hiddleston's Loki and a lot of his interaction with Chris Hemsworth, especially after Frigga's death in the movie, that's all the stuff that really worked for me and stands out. Everything else about this, eh.
Mm. Kasim?
All right, so I was prepared for this. I'm willing to die on this hill. I personally would give that movie a B, right?
Okay.
But I'm willing to die on the hill if y'all can just at least give the movie a C, okay? So that, I think it just set up a lot of important stuff for Loki's character, right? And I'm a Loki fan. It even gave Chris more, you know, room in my opinion. And I feel like Ragnarok couldn't have been as good without Thor of the Dark World. Because that little betrayal-like feeling that Thor gets, I think it was super important for the fourth movie.
Yeah.
The third movie.
Yeah. With Thor: The Dark World, I think it continues with the Marvel weak villain, you know, with the whole Dark Elves. But that was also the movie where Thor's mother also died in that. Which goes to more of Thor's tragic kind of life in these movies so far, you know, losing his mother, eventually losing his father in the third movie, losing his best friend.
And something that worked, they allow you to feel the emotion in that, and they let you grieve with the characters.
Yeah. And, you know, it does show that Thor, you know, really does, you know, as he always does, care about his brother Loki. You know, does love his brother, you know, even though they have this bad relationship. But I still...
And I do kind of agree with you, Kasim, that it does set up stuff later with the character of Loki. And honestly, the later movies ended up kind of making me retroactively appreciate this movie a lot more. I think After seeing Avengers Endgame, Thor's conversation with mother, it made that her death scene in the Dark World hit a lot harder for me, and especially after seeing Loki, you just appreciate more of Hiddleston's performance in all of the Thor movies.
Even having said all that, I would still give Thor 2 a D, because I just think it's absolutely forgettable in a way, in a lot of cases. I do sometimes I'll rewatch all the movies before the new one comes out, just to see, you know, how everything, you know, just has come so far. And that one is always one I always struggle to remember, you know, afterwards, after seeing it as many times as I have. So for me, I know Kasim was fighting hard for a C with this one, but I gotta go D. I'm gonna go D with it myself personally, with Thor: The Dark World.
Yeah, same. I personally put it as a D, but even with as low as I'm ranking it, I don't think Thor: The Dark World is a bad movie. There are other comic book movies just this year that came out that I would put Thor: The Dark World over in a heartbeat.
All right. Next up, Captain America: Winter Soldier. Where would you guys place this one?
Hey,
this is S tier, 10 out of 10, one of the greatest comic book movies and one of the just greatest movies of the 2010.
Wow. Wow. That's a big statement. Kasim, how do you feel about it?
I think it's an A-tier movie, regardless of... You can take that movie outside of Marvel, and I think it's still an A-tier movie. It looked great. The story was great. The emotion in it was great. It was just a great movie. Mm. To be honest, I like Iron Man 2 more than I like Avengers 2. I mean, not Iron Man 2, but Captain America 2 more than I like the second Avengers movie.
Yeah, I don't think that's such a controversial opinion. I think probably a lot of people
feel that way. That's not a hot take. That's pretty much... just the take.
Yeah, I agree. I think this is S tier. I think it's one of the few great movies that the MCU has. Love the act. This is when the Russo brothers, this is their first directed MCU movie. I think this contains one of the best action that the MCU has, mm-hmm. one of the few kind of best action movies that they have. The whole spy thriller aspect is very cool that they have here. I love, it introduces Anthony Mackie as Sam Wilson. It's got some nice, kind of really good funny moments. The on your left thing, that gets called back to a lot.
Throughout the movie. Setting up one of the greatest callbacks like 6 years in advance.
Yeah. So that was kind of very awesome. Bringing back the Winter Soldier, bringing back, Sebastian Stan.
Yeah, and this is the thing that puts this over to the S tier for me. I read Ed Brubaker's Winter Soldier comic. I knew what the twist was going to be the second I walked into the movie, and it happens, and it still emotionally works.
Yeah.
If I know a twist is coming and it still hits, that is the mark of an S tier movie for me.
Yeah.
What a twist.
yeah.
Get fucked, Shyamalan.
I think it's very effective. Nick Fury, Samuel Jackson does also a very good job in it. I think he does a solid job. The fight scene at the helicarrier, I think it's good. I mean, I don't think it's as, too much of the big action thing that they do typically at the end of these Marvel movies. I think it fits fine with what the structure of the movie is. Mm-hmm. I think it kind of fits fine. So for me, I would go with S tier myself with this. So moving it over into S tier with this one. Kasim, what is next up off memory? Do you know what came after Winter Soldier?
Is it an Avengers?
There's one movie before it.
One movie before it, yeah.
You got me stumped right there.
Oh, it is Guardians of the Galaxy.
Oh.
The first movie that James...
Guardians of the Galaxy was actually in the story that it always
And just the first movie that James Gunn was given full creative control along with like a couple $100 million budget.
So Guardians of the Galaxy, directed by James Gunn. This was, I think, a big surprise. People say, like, why are you doing a movie about Guardians of the Galaxy? Nobody knows really who these characters are.
Even for like very hardcore Marvel Comics fans, Guardians of the Galaxy was a huge deep cut.
So that was kind of a big surprise. And then it just blew up. I mean, it was a huge success. People loved Groot. People loved Rocket. Mm-hmm. People really loved, Gamora, Chris Pratt, Drax, Dave Bautista. This is where he really broke out. People really loved him. It was just this huge surprise. The James Gunn humor worked really well with the movie. I would have loved to see, though, Glenn Howard, who was from Always Sunny in Philadelphia.
Glenn Howerton.
Yeah.
Yeah. I do kind of wish we got that alternate timeline of Dennis Reynolds as Star-Lord.
Yeah. That would have been
especially, just considering how the kind of person that Chris Pratt turned out to be.
Yeah. I would have thought it'd been fun to see it. I like Chris Pratt as Star-Lord. I think he does a good job as Star-Lord.
I think he does well as Star-Lord, but this is basically the same character that he plays on Parks and Recreation.
Somewhat, I guess. Yeah, somewhat. Yeah. I mean, he's not as stupid as that guy, but somewhat.
Isn't he, though?
I think he's a little bit smarter. Kasim, where would you place Guardians of the Galaxy?
I'm gonna have to give Guardians of the Galaxy an S. It's Guardians of the Galaxy. There would be no Baby Yoda, Grogu for everybody without Baby Groot. I'm sorry. There would be no Baby Yoda without Baby Groot, and for that alone, S.
Yeah, I feel like I'd say this is probably in my A tier. The only reason that doesn't push it over the S is the villain problem with Marvel at the time. And like, gun to my head, I couldn't even tell you who
the villain was.
I couldn't tell you who the villain was. I couldn't tell you yet about what that character was trying to do. All I remember is that we got Josh Brolin finally debuting as Thanos.
Didn't he show up as Thanos at the end of the Avengers, didn't it? In the post-credit scene, right?
It was a different actor, and it was just a guy in makeup.
Oh, okay. Uh-huh. Okay, he didn't say anything in that. Oh, that's right, he didn't say anything in that. Yeah, so this one, I think it's, for me, A, close to S. With the villain problem, Lee Pace is Ronan the Accuser. I think they know the villain is goofy and they play into that. I mean, they beat the villain with a fucking dance battle, so they know that the shit's goofy. So they know is the shit's kind of the villain's, you know, kind of the way he is, classic kind of villain. I mean, it's almost like, I mean, a lot of inspiration for the villain and for the movie itself is like Flash Gordon and, you know, a lot of for that. So I think it kind of knows that. So the villain problem doesn't really bother me with that. Where am I going to go? Am I going to go S or am I going to go A? I think I'm gonna go.
I feel like you should go S.
Go S.
Come on, like this is the go S. This is the one movie where I feel like the whole issue with the villain problem thing doesn't matter, because the thing they really wanted to get out of this movie was just the love of those characters.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I do have an issue with the villain. Also, I think the second one's better.
Okay. All right. So I'll go S. Guardians of the Galaxy S. All right, so next up is, Kasim said, Avengers. Avengers 2, we have Age of Ultron. Joss Whedon returns to direct.
The Avengers, the 2 weeks of Ultron.
Yeah, you know what I mean? 2 weeks of Ultron. Tony Stark fucking up again, thinking he knows better. to be fair. Yeah,
this is Tony Stark's villain creation origin story.
Yeah. How many villains?
This is the movie where we said, shit, maybe this dude's gotta go, because he keeps creating villains that keep fucking up everybody's lives, especially like Peter Parker, as we will come to learn.
Yeah. Kasim, where would you place Age of Ultron?
Yeah, I'd give it a B.
B. Okay.
The movie wasn't anything special, but it did its job. It was, you know, big explosions, fast movie, story that made sense, set up a lot of stuff for the future. It's that nice middle child that just does the job.
Okay. Nick?
I'd say, for me, this is probably a C-tier movie. I think visually, it's a step up from the first Avengers. I think this is shot more like a film, whereas Marvel's The Avengers, it's shot like a television. I think it has one of my underrated villain performances with James Spader as Ultron. I think he's giving a performance that elevates what is probably on the page and one of the weaker characters. Also, this movie introduces Elizabeth Olsen as a Scarlet Witch and Paul Bettany's Vision, who become so important down the line. But I think my problem is just that this is kind of like the middle child in between the first Avengers and Infinity War.
Thank you, Cal. Thank you for the 100 bits, man. Thanks for joining.
Hey.
Really appreciate that, man. Hey, thanks for showing up. Thanks you could stop by. Age of Ultron. So, well, Joss Whedon returning, I think a lot of high expectations coming into it. Him directing the first Avengers, it being a big success, him doing a great job with that, a lot of people praising that. And I don't think it's as good as the first Avengers film. I think it looks better. There's some, you know, now that the Avengers are more of a team now, you get to see how more of they interact, the dynamics between all of them. you know, who has kind of closer relationships. Something that I think you didn't get to see the Avengers, because they don't really become the Avengers until the, like, the last 30 minutes of the movie. Mm-hmm. So this one, I think there's a benefit to that. James Spader's Ultron, I think, did a good job. I liked his voice for Ultron. It kind of reminded me how much I missed him when Ultron showed up in What If, and it was a completely different actor who voiced him. I was like, wow, I really kind of miss James Spader here as the voice of Ultron. I think he did a good job. I think a lot of this is just a lot of stuff. It's what Iron Man 2 suffered from. A lot of stuff going on because it's trying to stir so many different pots. It's like, okay, it's got the Thor storyline because it's trying to set up Ragnarok. It's got the stuff with Wanda and Quicksilver. The Quicksilver thing didn't really turn out to be anything because he turns into a bullet bag pretty early. And it's like how the fastest man, you know what I mean, is going to get shot by bullets, you know what I mean? You know, it's like, okay. So it kind of has that, but it does...
Because we got a way cooler version of that character like a couple months prior in Days of Future Past.
Yeah, with played by Evan Peters and the as Quicksilver there. Also, it has the kind of awkward Bruce Banner and Natasha Romanoff romance that didn't work for anybody all that much. Then there was that whole weird line about her not being a woman because she couldn't have kids. That was also
her being a monster because she can't have children. I was like,
yeah.
Didn't you used to assassinate people?
I think it was kind of trying to say that what was done to her. I think she was trying to say also killing people and also kind of being this assassin was made her, not just simply she couldn't have kids, but it was awkwardly put and very, this, it was kind of bad. There was that line by, I think, Tony Stark. Somebody pointed that out. Like, Tony Stark, the scene where they're all trying to lift the hammer, and then he says, like, I'm going to, like, when I lift the hammer, I'm going to reinstitute Prima Nocta or something like that. Like, somebody says, like, that's a, like, that was, like, an old rule or something like that when women could be raped or something like that. Or I forgot exactly what the whole big controversy with that was. I have to go find that again. But there was, like, a whole issue with that. But that scene was very fun, though, the whole where they try to all lift the hammer. That's a fun scene. So there's different scenes like that. And then I, you know, when Steve Rogers, he tries to lift it and nudges, and you see Chris Hemsworth's face, he go, oh, fuck. You know what I mean? That, like, that was a good, funny cut there. that was pretty good. So this is cool. No, yeah.
And again, setting up something, setting up one of the bigger payoffs in the MCU years in advance.
Yeah. So I thought that was kind of very cool. So I would give it, I'd put it kind of C myself, Age of Ultron. Nick, you gave it, you said what for it?
Yeah, I have it as a C tier. There are stuff that works about it, but especially in comparison to what comes later, this is probably the weakest Avengers film.
So I looked it up. So Prima Nocta was like this historical kind of thing, where it says the right of the Lord to insist on sex with any bride under his rule on her wedding night. That's what it was. Yeah, so that's what Tony Stark said when he was about to lift the hammer. He said, I'm going to reinstitute Prima Nocta. Yeah, so it was kind of a weird thing that was put in there. So for me, I would agree. I'd give it C tier myself. I think it's C, so we're going to move it on. Kasim, what is next after... Could you remember what's next after Age of Ultron?
I've been trying to get them straight off memories. I'm shot.
It is Ant-Man. Ant-Man is next. With Paul Rudd, directed by Peyton Reed. Originally, this was going to be directed by Edgar Wright. I would have loved to see this movie directed by Edgar Wright. He directed some of it before he left the project. You can still, I think, feel some of his influence involved.
This is one of the movies where, because we've heard stories about, like, directors coming in and finishing projects that were started by somebody else. And I think for at least this movie, I'm curious to see how much of Edgar Wright's draft made it onto the page.
Yeah. Kasim? Thoughts on Ant-Man?
Easy C. I didn't hate it. I didn't care that much about it, but I'll watch it if it's on TV.
Yeah, for me, this is kind of like a solid palate. You just did this like big potentially world ending thing in Age of Ultron with his final plan, and now you're just having this fun kind of quirky heist movie in between world ending events like Age of Ultron and Civil War.
Yeah, it's something smaller to kind of start off before Phase 3 kicks off. And the Ant-Man movies are, I think, the definition. I think when you point to like Marvel mid, I think you would point to the Ant-Man movies. They're perfect examples of that. Like, they're fine. They're serviceable. You know, you could, Kasim said, you can have them all, watch them. You know what I mean? I think they're perfect. This is the perfect description of C-tier. You know what I mean? And it kind of is just like, yeah, it's fine. I like the stuff that they do with the shrinking stuff. That's cool. That's something. And they do some creative fight scenes with that, which they improve upon in Ant-Man 2, Ant-Man and the Wasp. Paul Rudd, I mean, hey, he's Paul Rudd. He's the sexiest man alive. I mean, hey, good for him. Shout out.
He's the sexiest vampire alive.
Yeah, he's the second oldest man ever to get sexiest man alive behind Sean Connery, who got it in his 60s. You know what I mean? So great for him. Them rituals.
Sean Connery's voice got it in his 60s.
Yeah.
good for Paul Rudd for winning that. And I think this is kind of the movie that I think comedy fans always knew that Paul Rudd was kind of awesome. And I think he does a great performance as Scott Lang. And you also, this is kind of like the first time we see like legacy characters that we're getting in stuff like Hawkeye, of characters that have been other people before. And now we're seeing it again with the character like Hank Pym, who used to be Ant-Man in the movie.
Yeah. With Michael Douglas. Scott, you know what I mean? I always love the way he says his name there.
Scott.
Yeah. Evangeline Lilly as the Wasp here. Hope Van Dyne.
As the MVP of this movie, let's be honest. For me, it's either her or it's Michael Pena's as the MVP of the movie.
Yeah. I think Evangeline Lilly is one of the better romantic characters, love interests that they've had in these MCU movies. She actually, I think, has more of a valuable role than anybody else, like somebody like Rachel McAdams in the Doctor Strange movie or, someone like, who else?
Natalie Portman in the Thor movies.
Yeah, Natalie Portman. She puts it probably right along the line of like Haley Atwell in Captain America. Very valuable love interest, you know, has her own agency, is very cool in her own right. You know, it's not simply just, her only value is just, she's the love interest, she's the main character's love interest. You know, I think she has her own, cool things about her that makes her interesting. That they really do.
And the movie makes it very apparent that she should probably be the one in the suit.
Yeah.
Because she is already so much more competent at this whole shrinking and fighting and superhero stuff than Scott Lang is. Even in the sequel where Scott is full-fledged Ant-Man and she is still, like, running circles around his ass.
Yeah. So we all agree? C? Okay.
Yeah, C tier. It's one of my comfort MCU movies.
Okay. After Ant-Man, we got... What do we got, Nick? I'll let you go.
We got Captain America Civil War or The Avengers 2.5.
Yep. That's what a lot of people call it, Avengers 2.5. They just basically just took Captain America's third movie and I was like, fine, we'll just make it a Civil War movie. That's fine. This brings in the introduction of Spider-Man. That was a huge thing for a lot of people. The Russo brothers again come back to direct this.
This brought us Spider-Man and Chadwick Boseman's Black Panther.
Yep, and Black Panther. Yeah, rest in power to Chadwick Boseman as Black Panther. Enjoyed this movie a lot. I think this is very cool. Of course, this is, heavily kind of a little bit diverse from the Civil War comic, and they couldn't obviously.
I think it improves over the Civil War comic. I think that book works better in concept than it does in its actual execution. I just think Mark Millar, he's a good idea man, but he just doesn't know how to finish or write a story.
Kasim, what are your thoughts on Civil War? S. Okay.
S tier because of who introduces the story in it by itself is crazy. It's just a great movie.
Mm.
It's a good romance movie. You know, it started the bromance.
All of the great characters that it introduces. Again, Tom Holland's Peter Parker, who I think is still my favorite Spider-Man. Chadwick Boseman's Black Panther. Who was up there for me with the greatest comic book castings ever, up there with Robert Downey Jr. and Ryan Reynolds. And also Daniel Brühl as one of the more underrated villains in the MCU for me as Zemo, who we saw his turn in Falcon and the Winter Soldier. And he brought a lot of gravitas to a character that, in the hands of a lesser actor, I think would have just been a nothing villain.
Mm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Again, with this, I think very good action. Russo brothers delivered again, kind of with the action here.
Yeah. And great action. Second unit was done by Chad Stahelski, who directed the John Wick movies.
Mm. Yeah, so that's very, very impressive stuff. Like I said, the introduction of Black Panther, introduction of Spider-Man is very cool. I think, you know, the face-off with Iron Man and Captain America was a good payoff. I think their fight's very good. I love that scene, you know, when we all, because like I remember seeing the trailer for Civil War, and the last kind of shot of the trailer was them just beating the shit out of Iron Man. It was just double team. It was them passing the shield. And I was like, oh shit, this is good. This is getting good. And I thought that was great. There's I think a lot of good back and forth between Chris Evans, between Robert Downey Jr. in the movie before the big fight. That was nice. The opening of it is very impressive. You know, when they bring back Crossbones, who was in Winter Soldier, who's played by Frank Grillo. Good for Frank Grillo. He's having a nice little career on him, by the way, and kind of action movies and things like that. So good for him. I think he would have been a good Punisher. But now that's kind of ship has sailed now. But, you know, hey, I thought he would have been pretty good in that. I would say for me, Nick, what would you kind of put it?
I would say S tier purely because of the emotional stakes of this movie. This is, on paper, this is going to be another potentially world-ending thing. But also, it's so small scale when you really think about it. It's just this infighting between the Avengers and the airport fight scene. It's one of the greatest action set pieces in the Marvel Universe. Chris Evans, once again, delivering it as Steve Rogers. And just the greatest introductions to characters with Spider-Man and Black Panther.
Mm. Okay. I would say A, but outvoted. And this is going in S right here. Okay. So after that, we got Doctor Strange. Nick, where would you place Doctor Strange?
Doctor Strange is kind of in a weird spot for me. This is a movie that that is directed and written by two of my favorite people in Hollywood, Scott Derrickson, who's the director of stuff like Sinister, and C. Robert Cargill, who was his co-writer on that, and a lot of you know as formerly Carlisle on Spill.com.
Hmm.
And this brought over one of the greatest working actors today, in Benedict Cumberbatch, in as the role of Doctor Strange. But I think on a movie as it's on its own, this is probably closer in the B movie for me. I think it hints at more emotional depth in the case of its villain with Mads Mikkelsen. But I think he doesn't get enough time to develop because this is a origin story and it's moving very fast for an origin film. I think Benedict Cumberbatch, he does a great job with what he's given, and it introduces possibly one of the greatest side characters in Marvel with Benedict Wong as Wong.
Kasim.
All right, so actually this is going to have to be my last one, sadly.
Aw, man.
Yeah, I know. F's in the chat for your boy, but definitely a B. Cumberbatch was amazing. I said his name wrong. I'm so sorry, homie. Don't cancel me on Twitter. But he was amazing. The visuals were crazy. I see why they changed the Ancient One, but it was still not as bad as casting for Marvel, but I can live with it.
It's kind of a situation. Yeah, for me, it felt at the time it was kind of like a damned if you do, damned if you don't situation. But considering how amazing they did with the casting of Tony Leung as Wenwu and Shang-Chi, they could have done more. But I still love Tilda Swinton's performance.
Yeah. So, Kasim, you said a B with it? I think he clicked out there for a second. So for me, like you said, I like Scott Derrickson, I like Robert C. Cargill. The visuals are crazy. The visuals are great. You know, really open up more to the magic side of the MCU, which I thought was very impressive and very nice. And I thought that was very cool. And you said it introduces kind of Wong, you know, played by Benedict Wong, which is a very cool kind of character. Like the change they did with him, because in the comics, he was kind of more of a manservant there, so they made a good change there. Tilda Swinton is the Ancient One. I think she's fine in the role. Obviously, maybe you could have got maybe somebody who fit the role maybe a little bit better, the description of the character, but... You know, I think Tilda Swinton does fine in the role of the Ancient One. Benedict Cumberbatch, I mean, they said they purposely waited for him to be available so they can get him for Doctor Strange because they just believed he fit the character that much. And I think he does a good job in it. A lot of people...
He looks exactly like the character drawn in the comic.
Yeah. You know, a lot of people said this movie is also like Magic Iron Man, basically, kind of same origin story. You know, Dick, kind of rich guy, you know, gets humbled and then becomes a superhero. You know, and everything like that. But, I still think it's an enjoyable movie. I would kind of go around the B level myself with it. You would say B or as well?
I would say B as well. I think this is in my top five. Mostly just because of how much I enjoy it. But I wouldn't put this over any of the later ones. I'd still say this is a B movie for me.
B movie. Okay. Let me just find it right here real quick. Hold on just a second. Where do you have it here? Dang. Where is it? No, I just saw
it. It looks like Kasim's out.
Okay. Kasim.
Kasim for coming on. You can follow him on Instagram, Caution or Kasim Ruffin. He's got a fight scheduled, he said, sometime in January.
Yeah. Well, you ask him about the details. I'll put it in the description, put a link to it and everything like that. I'll do that, and you can buy his merch, all that stuff like that. So, yeah, thanks for him a lot for him for coming on. Really appreciate his help. Enjoyed having him on. B there as well. So after that, we have Guardians of the Galaxy 2. James Gunn returning. What kind of your thoughts about this?
To me, I think this takes everything that I liked about it and it improves on it massively. I think this is a much more personal and emotional story that they're telling in this film, especially with Peter Quill and the introduction of his father, Ego, the Living Planet, who's played wonderfully by Kurt Goddamn Russell. And for me, it's getting the emotional payoff of the arc that was introduced in the first one with Yondu and Michael Rooker, who is, for me, one of my favorite actors of all time. And he is incredible in this film as Yondu. And for me, this is a movie that every time I rewatch it, it gets to his funeral and I end up crying. This is probably the first one first Marvel movie I end up crying in.
At first, Guardians 2, I wasn't very high on it the first time I first saw it, but the more times I've gone to it, I've liked it a lot more. Think it's very, very good. Like I said, Yondu, the whole relationship he has with Star-Lord is very good. The funeral scene is very good. Kurt Russell's Ego, the Living Planet is great. I mean, Kurt Russell's always fantastic. And so that was very awesome. I think some of the stuff here, introducing Mantis, introducing the people that would eventually go on to make Adam Warlock. That's also kind of a big thing here. I think it has kind of like a little bit of that sequelitis thing where it tries to introduce all these different elements to set up for later, like the whole thing with the Ravengers, like with Sylvester Stallone, because this movie has like what, four post-credit scenes, like four kind of different, you know, after-credit scenes.
Yeah, you could take any of the post-credit scenes in this and do a Disney Plus show on.
Yeah, and this is where Michelle Yeoh showed up, so this is her first appearance in the MCU.
Yeah, Michelle Yeoh, Michael Rosenbaum. I didn't know this at the time, but the original the galaxy in the comic.
Yeah, you kind of cut out there for when you kind of saying the names.
Oh, yeah, Michelle Yeoh, Miley Cyrus, Michael Rosenbaum, and good old Rocky himself, Sly Stallone, as the original Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah. I wouldn't mind seeing a Disney Plus show with them. I don't know if they're ever going to return to that, because I know somebody asked James Gunn on Twitter, like, are we ever going to get a follow-up on that? And usually he responds on Twitter, you know, to different people, like rumors and stuff like that. I don't think I saw him respond to that. But I would like to see a follow-up with that and everything, to see them kind of do a whole adventure, you know, kind of like a little Disney Plus show. I wouldn't mind. I think with the Dave Bautista character, you know, as Drax, I think he's doing a little too much, you know what I mean, in the film, you know, kind of being like trying to be too much of the comic relief. I thought it was fine the way he was, kind of being this guy, you know, who didn't understand metaphors, you know, being kind of a funny straight man in a way. I think they kind of try to do too much with his character in the second one. Mm-hmm.
I think I agree with you, but I think Batista pulls it off. Mm. And it's kind of weird that out of all the guys to come over from WWE, he's probably the one who's ended up becoming the best actor out of all of them.
Yeah, very sure. You see him in different stuff like Blade Runner. You know what I mean? You know, he's got a good knack for dramatic stuff.
And Blade Runner, stuff like Army of the Dead, which...
You cut out there again.
Yeah, stuff like Blade Runner 2049, where he's incredible. Stuff like Army of the Dead, which say what you will about that movie, I still think he's giving a great performance in that.
Yeah, I think it's solid. Dune, I think he does a good job in Dune as well. I would give it personally, I would say A tier myself. What would you say?
I would give this an A tier as well.
Okay, so yeah, so A tier for that as well. Let's see here. Guardians of the Galaxy 2. Also, awesome soundtrack, by the way. Always with all these guys. Movies.
Yeah, initially when I first saw it, I think I liked this soundtrack a little less than I did for the first one, but honestly, it grew on me the more I listened to it.
Okay. Alright, so after Guardians of the Galaxy 2, Spider-Man Homecoming. Where would you place this one?
I would put this as a solid... I would put this as a solid A tier movie for me. I think, again, this is something that was kind of needed for this take on Spider-Man. We needed a guy who's like a lot more, whose story is a lot more grounded and dealing with more of the street level stuff. And especially in contrast to a character like Tony Stark, Doctor Strange, Captain America, where they're going on these big epic adventures in all of their movies. And we're getting something, more on the street level, more friendly neighborhood.
Yeah.
And also one of the best villain performances of Michael Keaton as the Vulture.
Yeah. Like I said, it's much smaller scale. It's him in the neighborhood. The Vulture is not trying to destroy the world. He's not trying to destroy New York. He's just trying to steal some stuff so he can make some money. Simple kind of thing going on. That's perfect.
He's trying to make some money after getting screwed over by Tony Stark.
Yeah, another villain on the Tony Stark list.
Yeah, Tony Stark is like about 1 in 3 for fucking up Peter Parker's life.
Yeah, Tom Holland as Peter Parker is great. I think he's a great Spider-Man. Great
He brings a charm and innocence that I, with the two previous actors, I put them in like a different category. It's kind of like how... we've gotten Batman before. You have a guy who's either good at being Peter Parker, or you have a guy who's good at Spider-Man. I don't think we've had one who's good at both until like Tom Holland.
Mm. Yeah. So I think, he does a very, very good job in the role. I like he's in high school with other people that look like high schoolers. He's not in it with a bunch of 30-year-olds.
Yeah, you're not getting a 35-year-old Joe Manganiello who looks older than all the teachers playing the high school bully.
Yeah, so you got that. You know, nice kind of people that round out the cast. Like, you know, you have...
you also don't have, like, 6 foot tall Andrew Garfield skater bro.
Yeah.
And suddenly he can't get no girls. Man, fuck off with that.
Yeah, you know, I think it's perfectly good. You know, Michael Keaton as the Vulture does a very good job. Zendaya, you have Hannibal Buress, who's like the high school gym coach, who's very funny.
One of my favorite offhanded jokes. It's like they're doing like the fitness challenge videos that you get in Cap in his old Avengers uniform. It's like, thank you, Captain America. Pretty sure he's a war criminal now, but it's required by the state.
Yeah, that was pretty funny. You know, so it's nice kind of, you know, good humor in it. That's very, you know, kind of nice. I think works well in this movie.
And something that was cool, I think it was either this movie or Doctor Strange that started off the trend of going after these smaller scale indie directors. Because this and Far From Home are both directed by John Watts, who, to my knowledge, his only movie prior to this was that indie film Cop Car with Kevin Bacon.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I guess you could say James Gunn was an indie kind of director before he did Guardians. Because he only did, like, kind of small stuff like Slither and things like that. And
I guess so.
Yeah. For me, I would say Spider-Man Homecoming, I'd say high B. Maybe A? What would you say?
I would say high B as well.
Okay.
I do have some issues with a little bit of the over-reliance of CG with the Spider-Man, especially because you look at behind-the-scenes stuff, and you know Tom Holland can do a lot of this.
Yeah. So I'd say, so we're going to go high B for right now. So we're going to put it in front of Iron Man 3 on the B category for right now. Yeah, there we go. Okay, all right. Next up is Thor Ragnarok. Where would you place Thor Ragnarok?
For me, this is an S-tier movie. This is one of my favorite Marvel movies to watch. It's just so tightly written, the comedy beats. It's one of the funniest movies in the MCU, and I think a lot of that is up to the direction of Taika Waititi, who is one of the greatest comedic minds working today off of stuff like What We Do in the Shadows, Hunt for the Wilder People, and Jojo Rabbit.
Hmm. Yeah, I think when people say that, you know, Marvel doesn't really have an identity, that they don't really let directors have much of a say, I mean, I still think Marvel obviously is in much control, and directors, they kind of come in and kind of do their thing, you know, in, you know, trying to work in their little space of what Marvel wants them to do. But I think very much like Taika Waititi with his humor. Go ahead.
Yeah, I think that critique is bullshit, first off. Also, I don't think if, say, Warner Brothers called Taika to do, I don't think they would have given him nearly as much freedom as they do with the Thor movie. Mm-hmm. Also, because this is kind of the film that saved the Thor franchise. Thor, for the longest time, he was kind of that character that everyone liked to look at, but there wasn't really anything special films, and I think this is the one that the studio realized, hey, Chris Hemsworth is a really funny guy, what if we just made this as this kind of like Flash Gordon-esque comedy?
Yeah. And it worked. You know what I mean? And I think having Jeff Goldblum in there, you know, as the Grandmaster really was great. Bringing in Tessa Thompson as Valkyrie, which was awesome. You know, it's kind of weird that her name is Valkyrie, but she's also a Valkyrie. I don't know even if she has a actual name. They just call her Valkyrie.
I think she's credited as Brunhilde.
Oh, okay.
But everyone just calls her Valkyrie.
Okay. Yeah, because I was like, that's kind of
weird. And also underrated villain performance from Cate Blanchett as Hela, the goddess of death.
Yeah, great performance from her. I'm still hoping she may maybe make a return one day, because she was great. Mm-hmm. I mean, she really, it was kind of like, it was a little bit like what they did with the Guardians villain, where they knew it was kind of like a cheesy villain of her whole plan. It's like, I want to destroy
him. Yeah, they know it's a cheesy villain, and they just allow Cate Blanchett to chew on all of the scenery.
Yeah, and she's absolutely great. I mean, she's one of the, I think, the better MCU villains that they've had. And she's absolutely great. Thor Ragnarok, let's see. I would go between an A and an S myself. What would you say?
This is a solid S tier for me. I absolutely adore this movie. This is on my... I think I end up rewatching this one about like once every couple months.
Yeah. They also do try to bring in the World War Hulk storyline there. Which
yeah, this is probably as close as we're ever going to get to a Hulk movie while the rights are still kind of in flux. Because I think with Universal, they're still not allowed to do a solo Hulk movie.
Yeah, I heard something. They said they're going to do another World War Hulk movie. They're going to do a World War Hulk movie. That's what I heard. That's what I read in something. So I'd say, okay, so we're going to move it to S. I could see S. That's fine. I could see S. And when we're done ranking all of them and putting them in the categories, we're going to rearrange them in their own like little category there real quick afterwards.
For sure. We've gone on for almost an hour and a half.
Yeah. I didn't expect to go on this long, but yeah, they got a lot of movies here. So we try to speed run.
Wow. Who knew that 23 movies could take so long?
Yeah. Let's speed run kind of through this as much as we can. So Black Panther.
Okay. All right. Speed run. S tier for me.
S tier. Like the movie. Don't like the ending. I think kind of somewhat Black Panther gets a little overshadowed in his own movie by Killmonger. I think the
true, but I think for the story they're trying to tell, it works for the film.
Yeah. Some of the effects look pretty bad, especially towards the end. Like Chadwick Boseman's Black Panther. Like them introducing a new character. I think some of what Wakanda they show is kind of small scale. A lot of it is a little bit. And I do like the soundtrack. I love when Goran sent the score. The soundtrack is really great. I love the music. Like, you know, that's kind of come like synonymous with a lot of Black Panther stuff. It's like anytime they introduce a character for Wakanda, you hear that music playing, that do-do-do, you hear that. You hear that music playing. It's like, oh, shit. You know what I mean? Like, that's what happened. Falcon and the Winter Soldier, as soon as the Dora Milaje came on. You hear that music.
As soon as the Dora came along, yep. There come them drums.
Yeah, so I thought that was pretty awesome. I thought that was good. So for me, but I still think it's kind of still, I think I would say B for me. I would say probably B for me.
S mostly because you get, to this day, it's between him and Josh Brolin now it's him, Josh Brolin, and Tony Leung as the greatest villains in the MCU with Michael B. Jordan.
Yeah, so I'll compromise going the middle, A.
All right, A works for me.
Okay. Let's see here. Also, let's go. Avengers Infinity War.
This is S for me as well. I remember being there opening night. I saw this movie 3 times in the theater, and every single beat of it works, even on rewatch.
Yeah, I would have to agree. This is, like I say, one of the few kind of MCU movies I think is great, like with Captain America Winter Soldier. Awesome movie. Remember seeing it in theaters, packed theater. People were just, you know, excited to see it. I remember this
movie. Yeah, one of the greatest times I've had in the theater. Everyone laughing. Time.
Yeah. And I remember it funny because at the end where, you know, Thanos, he does his mission, snaps, and then everybody's going away. And oh hey, how's it going there, X7? Hey man, how's it going? Thanks for coming by. I remember in the theater when that moment happened, when the snap happened, and everybody fading away, and I remember it was Black Panther, and I heard just one black dude go, "What the fuck? What the hell?"
Yeah, the friends I was with at the time, they saw it, they say, "No!"
Yeah, it's like that was just like one of the great moments. The whole theater was just silent. And all you hear him go, "What the fuck?" Like, what the? Yeah. So I thought that was pretty cool. Yeah, I mean, I think it does such a great job. I mean, Russo brothers coming to do it, and then how they balanced all the stuff they had to do with that movie, introducing all these characters, putting them all in here, and then it's like each it's like they separated into different squads. It's like, okay, you got your space squad, you got your Earth squad. You got your squad that's kind of like, you know, gathering the people, helping them to safety, like, you know, Captain America, you know, and Iron Man up with the Guardians in space. And I thought that was kind of really well done and awesome. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I would definitely say S tier here. Next up, we're going to have Ant-Man and the Wasp.
Ant-Man and the Wasp, I'd say it's a solid B tier. I think I like it a little more than the first Ant-Man movie, but... again, this is kind of like the palate cleanser in between Infinity War and Endgame.
Yeah. Good that you just got to work X7. Hope you had a good day at work. Yeah. Ant-Man and the Wasp, I think it's better than the first Ant-Man. I think they do more stuff with the shrinking, going small, going big. Mm-hmm. I think is much better. I like the addition of Lawrence Fishburne was pretty nice. As Goliath, showing more of the history of like S.H.I.E.L.D., things like that. I did like the villain of Ghost. Mm-hmm. Hope to see her back and maybe like a Dark Avengers scenario.
Yeah, maybe like a Thunderbolts thing going on.
Yeah. I'd give it B. I'd say B.
Mm.
B. All right. So after Ant-Man and the Wasp, we got Captain Marvel. Where would you
For me, this is probably a C tier. I think the biggest problem this movie has is it doesn't give a I don't think Carol Danvers is really well developed in her own movie.
Mm.
I think she starts off as the baddest motherfucker in the room, and she pretty much just stays there for the entire film. I think, but I don't blame that on Brie Larson at all. I think she's given she's doing the best with what she's given. I just don't think that the two people writing and directing that film were the right fit. I am way more interested in seeing what Nia DaCosta does with her in the Marvel.
Mm, yeah. With this movie, yeah, I think it's kind of a weaker movie. I'd say high D or low C, kind of somewhere kind of in the middle there. I think, like you said, I mean, the 90s kind of aesthetic of it. They just kind of do a lot of, you know, kind of 90s references, 90s music. They do the worst thing a prequel could do. They kind of explain all this different stuff, like how Nick Fury lost his eye, and it contradicts stuff that we've already seen, like the whole S.H.I.E.L.D. name. It's like in the first Iron Man, S.H.I.E.L.D., they weren't condensed to just S.H.I.E.L.D. Like, they would say the whole name, but you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But then they contradict that in the first Captain Marvel. I think Brie Larson, like you said, I think she's working with the best she can. I mean, this movie also had like a lot of writers on it. I think it had like 3 or 4 writers on this. Hopefully.
Yeah. Yeah. But then again, most Marvel movies do end up having like 3 or 4 writers, but this is the one where I think it shows the most.
Yeah. And the whole thing, like, I think it would have been cool, like a superhero memento. That's kind of cool in concept. But the thing is, we already know who she is. So her finding out who she isn't interesting, because we already know she's a superhero. Mm-hmm. We already know her kind of, she's this pilot, whatever, blah, blah, blah. So it's kind of like, okay, this isn't really all that interesting. So I would say pretty much maybe high D. What would you say?
Yeah, I would say a low C. I still think the best part about this is Stan as a younger Nick Fury, and seeing his dynamic with Brie Larson, and also the twist of Ben Mendelsohn as the Skrulls, which, come on, you get Ben Mendelsohn to play a villain.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's kind of like just expectation subversion by casting that I think works really well for the film.
Mm, yeah. So I'm going to say, okay, so low, kind of low C here, put it at the end here of that. Next up, we got Avengers Endgame. Where would you place this?
S tier. Just like with Infinity War, I think this gives the conclusion of that story, allows you to spend time with the characters that, just by the nature of the kind of movie it is, kind of got the shaft in Infinity War. Mm. And you get to tell this like expansive emotional story that works for me every time I rewatch the film.
Mm. I would say high A or kind of middle A myself. Yeah, I think it's, you know, like people say, well, it's a fan. It's like basically fan service. I'm like, yeah, I mean, that's, yeah, basically, I mean, it's Marvel sucking its own D. I mean, that's basically, it's just saying like, hey, you loved us for this long.
It's Marvel pulling a Joe Rogan.
Yeah, I mean, pretty much. I mean, because it's just, yeah, I mean, it's like, hey, it has all these callbacks to their movies, to Winter Soldier, to the first Iron Man, everything like
that. Calling back to stuff that was set up almost a decade ago, and to come out on Marvel's 10th anniversary, it's chef's kiss, bravo.
Yeah, and they said like, oh, you know, the big battle at the end, and that was, I was like, hey, you know, when he said Avengers assemble at the right moment when it just had to be said, and it was like, you know, shit, you know what I mean? Okay, that was exciting. I mean, it was theater reactions when that happened, when Captain America picked up the hammer, and when he did all that, it was kind of just like,
yeah. Yeah, I saw this movie. I think I had like a AMC dubs at the time, so I could like see three movies a week. I wore that motherfucker out seeing this movie like five times.
Yeah. And they did kind of cheat though with the whole trying to make it the highest grossing movie of all time because they re-released it.
Yeah, that was some bullshit.
You know, they did kind of cheat though, but yeah, they got it. I'd say, so you say S?
Yeah, I say S. This is a movie that if I rewatch it multiple times and I still cry at the exact same spots each time, it works. It's an S tier for me.
Yeah. I feel like this is the perfect closing chapter. Like, if you follow these things, it's like you don't have to watch any other Marvel thing. Like, if you didn't want to, I think you could close it out right here. If you're like, I'm sick of this Marvel shit, you could probably just watch this, be done with it, and just be fine. Spider-Man, yeah. Far From Home, where are you placing it?
Spider-Man Far From Home, I think it's an A. I think, again, Tom Holland giving a perfect performance. This is kind of like the epilogue to the Infinity Saga, dealing with the fallout of Tony Stark's death and how that influenced Peter Parker as a hero and as a person. And also Jake Gyllenhaal as one of the best villains in the MCU in his Mysterio.
Oh, okay. Hey, thank you, by the way, Bunny, for the lurk. Thank you very much. Thanks for stopping by. Spider-Man Far From Home. It's tough. I don't think it's as good as maybe Homecoming. I think maybe they're a little bit on the same level. I do like Jake Gyllenhaal as Mysterio coming in. I do like the developing relationship of Peter Parker and MJ. I think they're kind of right at the same level there for me. I would say maybe low A, maybe B with Spider-Man Homecoming myself. I'd say maybe B with Far From Home. And you said what? You said A?
Yeah, I said A. I enjoy this movie a lot. I love Tom Holland's portrayal of Peter Parker, especially something that we touched on in Iron Man 3, him dealing with the after of these Avengers-level events.
Yeah. And then it does some funny stuff with the snap, like afterwards, like after that, of how everybody came back and people are older. And that was kind of very funny, I thought.
Yeah, it was played as a comedic bit versus something that we get in stuff like WandaVision or Falcon and the Winter Soldier, where it's treated with as much gravitas as something like that would deserve.
Yeah.
I think because we're mostly following teenagers who are like kind of shitty and treat everything like that, it works for the tone that they're setting up in this movie.
Yeah. So I'll go low A because all right, so now we're getting into the shows. WandaVision, where would you place it?
WandaVision, I have issues with the ending, but besides that, I think this is A tier product. In an age where Marvel sometimes very fairly gets criticized for kind of being homogenous, a lot of it being the same thing, this took a swing into doing something experimental and different with playing around with different sitcom genres.
Yeah, I thought that was very inspired. They even had Dick Van Dyke come on and consult for the show, a guy who's a veteran of those type of sitcoms that they were aping and they were parroting.
Filming the first two episodes with a live studio audience which is nuts to me.
Yeah, so they really, really try to capture that style, bringing in Monica Rambeau, an older version of her. I think it was very cool. You know, knockout performance. Who was the actress who played Catherine Hahn, who played Agatha Harkness?
Yes, knockout performance. Yes, a fucking star-making performance. And Catherine Hahn, who's one of the greatest working character actors, they give her the respect she deserves. And also, Agatha all along is a straight up banger.
Yeah. Yeah. Very fun to listen to. So, and then Elizabeth Olsen gives her a chance to really act. You know, sometimes in these superhero movies, it's tough.
Yeah. Just by the virtue of what the Avengers movie, they're big ensemble films, you don't get as much time to develop with some of the other characters. And Wanda, and Elizabeth Olsen, she nails it here. And Paul Bettany getting to show off his comedic chops as the Vision.
Yeah, and Paul Bettany are very good there. And the, how they transition from the history of TV, from where we are, you know, from all the way back in the 50s to all the way now. They do the whole, you know, The Office, you know what I mean? Documentary style, I thought was very funny. And Paul Bettany, another guy who's got a talent for comedy, very much so. So I would say, I'd say the ending I don't like as much. Kind of a weak ending.
I think a lot of it got cut, but mostly because I think this was the first one Marvel was able to COVID.
Yeah.
Because while this was in production, COVID was shutting down a lot of Hollywood. And I think this was the first one back that they were able to finish.
Yeah. So I give it A. I have no problem putting it in A. I think it's very good. Very good performances there. Next up, we have Falcon and the Winter Soldier. Where would you place this?
Ooh, I absolutely adored this show. I give this a tier for me. Just purely of the thematic elements and just talking about race relations and modern politics in a way that I was not expecting the Marvel Universe to go there. And giving some of the greatest side performances and character introductions from characters like Carl Lumley as Isaiah Bradley and Wyatt Russell as John Walker. He's a fascinating character to watch. I think this show is spectacular.
Same situation with WandaVision a little bit, where I hated the ending. Didn't really like the ending all that much. Think it's kind of a weak ending. Like the combination of Sebastian Stan and Anthony Mackie. They had good, funny chemistry. You saw them when they were in Civil War, when they were Winter Soldier together. Kind of good stuff there. And I thought that was really good. I like seeing Anthony Mackie become, Captain America. Good to see he's going to get his own movie, not just a season, another season of the show. So I think that's good. The Flag Smashers, good villains.
Yeah, the Flag Smashers are kind of weak. I think Erin Kellyman, I think she does an okay job of trying to give them depth. But I think the production was a victim of COVID as well, because I remember reading that there was a subplot involving like a virus that was ended up getting on the cutting room floor.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
And that virus subplot would have been an entire episode with the Flag Smashers.
Ah, okay. Thank you, Javon Good, for the 100 bits. Thank you for coming in, man.
Thank you.
Much appreciated, man. I think the Flag Smashers, this was a production also hindered by COVID, so they cut some episodes of this. So it feels kind of rushed, the stuff they did with them. It's like, okay, we got to make them clear villains so everybody knows how to hate them, so they just kill civilians, even though that contradicts all the stuff that they said before and did before about them protecting civilians. They have no problem now with killing civilians and them getting in the way. I was like, okay, so it's just obviously you got to make them the clear villains to root against, and everything like that. And like I said, the issues with the ending was just like the whole stuff with Isaiah Bradley. Like, he gets a little statue in the back of the museum, stuff like that. I was like, okay, basic kind of, posturing, there.
And it also doesn't help that Carl Lumley got snubbed by the Emmys and they gave Don Cheadle the fucking nod.
Yeah, that was also weird. He's only in one episode he's only in like one episode for like 5 minutes or something. I would say B for me. What would you say?
I give it a solid A. I love this show. I just rewatched the final episode last night. And that speech that Anthony Mackie gives towards a lot of the politicians at the end, that still hits me.
Oh, I think that's kind of corny myself. I thought that was really corny. But I'll say, okay, so low A. I'll give it a low A there. Okay, Loki season one.
Loki season one is, I'd say it's the highest point of the MCU. Tenure on Disney Plus. I think this is the show that everything that was kind of built up in WandaVision, as this is us going experimental, this is us playing around with different genres and introducing new concepts like the multiverse into the MCU, it does it perfectly. And for me, this is a solid S-tier show.
S-tier. I like Tom Hiddleston back as Loki. He's always great as the role. I like what they do with the expansion of the whole multiverse. Things like, having the whole, kind of like this futuristic technology, but it looks old school. I think Owen Wilson does a great job in the show as well. I think when Loki meets the other versions of Loki is a great episode. I think this has the best ending out of all the Disney Plus shows.
Oh, yes. And something that I think the MCU should lean more into, the ending of this season, it's small scale. Well, it is a very like potentially world changing event, but the focus is on this small conflict between Loki and Sylvie, who I think is played wonderfully by a Sofia DiMartino.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. So this one for me, Loki. I'd say great ending. Some would say between A for me. You said S.
Yeah, this is S. Also introducing us to Jonathan Majors as He Who Remains. One of the best cameos, and something that sets up the future of the MCU, because we know he is coming back as Kang the Conqueror.
Okay. So I'll say high A. Good with that? High A.
Yeah, I'm good with a high A.
Okay. Next, Black Widow.
This is a movie that the elements of it that work really work, especially Florence Pugh's performance. I really like David Harbour in the movie, but this is probably a D for me in the MCU.
Yeah, I would agree. I like bringing in David Harbour, Rachel Weisz. I think this movie really is Florence Pugh's movie more than Scarlett Johansson's Black Widow. They should have did this movie right after Civil War. I mean, it was too little, too late.
This movie came out 5 years too late.
The whole thing with the villain, you don't really get a sense of the villain because he doesn't show up until the very end. I like the whole element of the sex trafficking kind of, politics they kind of bring into it, but they don't, I think it's kind of lazy a little bit in the movie. I think you could have really had a good heart punch with it, but it's just kind of like the whole thing with you just spray some dust in their face and they snap out of the mind control. I was like, okay, that's just kind of, okay, whatever. That's kind of stupid and basic. I'd give it a high D somewhere and kind of like at the D.
Yeah, I'd give it a high D. I think the biggest mistake this does is taking away a lot of Taskmaster. Yeah. Because in the comics, he's a character that is basically Marvel's Deathstroke. And something that I think was a mistake was basically making him just her a mindless drone. But I think there's room for that character to come back and get the development that it deserves, that she deserves.
Yeah. What if?
What if? I'd say B. I think, like we said, where this is the MCU experimenting with different genres and different art style, but something that's more animated and something that is getting a spinoff, because we are getting Marvel Zombie on Disney Plus sometime in the near future. But I think I would have preferred it if all of these stories stayed separate. If this stuck to its gun as the MCU's Twilight Zone.
It being all connected at the end. I would have much preferred not all the episodes had to connect with each other. Some of the stuff, I think some of the episodes were kind of weak, like Captain Carter episode. I didn't think it was all that good. I think when they start to get more experiment, because some of the episodes were just, well, what if just this other reverse situation happened? Like, what if Captain Carter was, the Captain America character and not Steve Rogers? What if, T'Challa was just Star-Lord? Even though I do really like that Star-Lord episode with T'Challa, I just thought that was kind of like a lot of the reverse of that. I would agree, and I would say kind of B for myself. I would say kind of somewhere low B.
I appreciate the balls that this show has, and I can't wait to see what they do with it too, because I've heard rumblings about, like, do more stuff with the Guardians, do stuff with, like, Shang-Chi and the Ten Rings in future seasons, stuff with the Eternals. The latter of Phase 4 have introduced some interesting concepts that I think What If can have a lot of fun with.
Yeah. Shang-Chi.
This is my current favorite of Marvel. This is a movie that, as an Asian American, it felt so good to be represented with this, like, $200 million blockbuster, have it do so well at the box office, make a star-making performance from Simu Liu, who I think is one of the most charming characters, and this is probably one of the best introductions to a character that Marvel's done in a very long time. I absolutely love this film. I rewatched it last night. It hits just as well emotionally the second time. I do have issues with the ending and how it does go into this kind of a big CGI fest, but I think it works more because you have this hugely emotional fight scene between Shang-Chi and Wenwu, and you have that very tearful goodbye that only an actor like Tony Leung could have pulled off.
Yeah. I agree, you know, about the ending. Yeah, the ending just goes off the rails for me. I was like, this was a cool martial arts movie, and then you just had to do that ending, the big Marvel ending that we all talk about. You know, it's just like, yeah, that kind of drops it down for me. One of the best action kind of scenes they have in this movie are some of the best in the entire MCU. Ranks right up there. I think Simon Liu is a great addition to it. I think he's great. He's got great comedic timing. I see why they picked him over someone like, you know, what was his name? Louis Tan. I see why they kind of did that, because he had more of a comedic background, being in Kim's Convenience. So yeah, I would say
star making films from both him and Manger Kong.
Oh, hey, thanks Javon Gill for playing the afternoon delight. Hey, thanks a lot, man. I would say personally it's B. I would say it's a B for me. You said S?
Yeah, I fucking adore this movie.
Okay, so in the middle, go A. In the middle,
all right, yeah, that works for me.
Okay, and the final, Eternals, where are you putting that?
Eternals, this is a movie that I do have a lot of issues with, but at the same time, purely just because of the ambition that it has with trying to tell this story about God and about faith. And doing it in a way that I don't think feels preachy in the least bit. I think for me, this is probably a B film for me.
Mm.
I understand a lot. I do have issues with the pacing of the film. I think it would have worked better if it was told more linearly. But the performances and some of the visuals of this, I think they managed to sell it.
Mm. This is the most recent Marvel movie directed by Chloe Zhao, Oscar-winning director, the first Oscar-winning director they've ever had directed a Marvel movie. I mean, you know, they're trying to bring in themes of existentialism, these kind of broader kind of themes she's trying to bring in here, deeper themes. And I think it struggles because you have eight characters and you're trying to give some of them screen time and try and develop them. You know, don't really think they you know, really have much character in it. It struggles with that. I think the length is also a problem, how long it is. I think somewhat it's kind of dull. I think that a lot of the action scenes also are not that good, not that interesting to watch. I think that also, you know, I think, you know, as a lead character, Gemma Chan is really not all that interesting here. Like, again, it goes to about, like, what are these people's, like, what are their characters? Like, what's Gemma Chan's character all that much? And what's kind of purpose? And the whole kind of final kind of battle at the end, it's better than a lot of the other big battles that happen. It's not so overly, you know, cluttered. It's just that what was the exact execution of the plan that they had didn't really make a lot of sense. I'm not going to talk about it much because it's still out there. It's still fresh, but it was just kind of like, I didn't really understand that plan all that much. For me, I'd say it's low C. C.
All right.
Low C. Okay. So that was it. So real quick, we're going to just go through, this tier list doesn't have the posters for Eternals or Shang-Chi, so I couldn't put them on there, but just imagine that they're just up there real quick. So just gonna go up, rearrange it. So D, we have first Black Widow, Incredible Hulk, Iron Man 2, Thor 2. Do you want to rearrange any of that?
No, that works fine for me.
Okay. I would say Incredible Hulk is better than Black Widow. I'd say maybe Iron Man 2 is better than Black Widow. That's just me. And then I'd say Black Widow is probably better than Thor 2, but that's just me.
But, all right, yeah.
Okay, so that's just me. Next up, we have C. We have Thor, Age of Ultron, Ant-Man, Captain Marvel. Would you rearrange any of these?
I think I like Ant-Man a lot more than Thor. And Age of Ultron, I'd put it above Thor as well.
I agree. I would say Thor is it better than Captain Marvel? I'd say I don't know. I think Thor is maybe I like maybe Captain Marvel slightly better, maybe slightly. But I don't know. I wouldn't fight you on it if you said Thor was better slightly. Because I still so I still go low C with Captain Marvel. B, we got Spider-Man Homecoming, we have Doctor Strange, we have Iron Man 2, we have Ant-Man and the Wasp, we have What If. Also, oh, I forgot with the C tier, we have Eternals. So would you still keep Eternals the last spot?
I'd put Eternals probably below Age of Ultron.
Below Age, so okay, so it'd be between. Okay, so yeah, so yeah. There. Okay, so yeah, so Ant-Man and the Wasp, What If, and Shang-Chi. At we put Shang-Chi B, right? Oh, A. We put it A, right?
Or
A.
Yeah, we put it at A. Okay. You said B, I said S, so we're kind of meeting in the middle at A.
Okay, so it's an A. So B is Spider-Man Homecoming, Doctor Strange, Iron Man 3, Ant-Man and the Wasp, What If. You good with that?
I'd say Iron Man 3, then What If, then Far From Home, and then Doctor Strange and Ant-Man.
Okay, so Iron Man 3, What If, Homecoming, and then Doctor Strange and Ant-Man and the Wasp.
Yeah, that works for me.
Okay. All right. So A, First Avenger, Loki, Guardians of the Galaxy 2, Black Panther, Far From Home, WandaVision, Falcon and the Winter Soldier, and Shang-Chi.
I think for me personally, Black Panther, I think it's the top of A tier, then WandaVision and everything. And then Loki, and then everything else is kind of just interchangeable.
Okay, so you said Black Panther, Loki, and then everything else is interchangeable.
Yeah.
Okay. I'd say low A would probably be maybe Falcon and the Winter Soldier would be low A. Also there, I'd say Shang-Chi is better than Far From Home.
So I would agree. I would agree with you there. Yeah. I enjoy Shang-Chi a lot more than I did Far From Home.
I enjoy WandaVision better than First Avenger. I'd enjoy Guardians 2 better than First Avenger. And then, so after First Avenger, so Black Panther, Loki, WandaVision, Guardians of the Galaxy 2, First Avenger, I would put... Actually, I like Shang-Chi better than First Avenger, honestly. So I'd move that over there. So Shang-Chi, then First Avenger, then Falcon and the Winter Soldier, then Far From Home. I'd probably have it like that.
All right.
S tier, Iron Man, Avengers, Captain America, Winter Soldier, Guardians of the Galaxy 1, Civil War, Thor Ragnarok, Infinity War, and Endgame. Would you rearrange?
I think the top of it is definitely going to be Winter Soldier. After that, I'd say Infinity War, Thor Ragnarok, and then everything else is interchangeable.
For me, I would go Infinity War 1. I think that was great. I would go Winter Soldier 2nd. I'd go Iron Man 3, and I would go maybe Endgame after that. I'd go maybe the first Avengers, maybe.
All right.
I don't know. I think I like Guardians better than I like Avengers. First Guardians.
Okay.
Thor Ragnarok I like better than Civil War. Thor Ragnarok I like probably better than First Avengers. So, Infinity War, Winter Soldier, Iron Man, Endgame, Guardians of the Galaxy, Thor, Ragnarok, Avengers, and Civil War.
Yeah, that works for me.
All right. So, that is our definitive tier list here, people. Yeah, so just imagine, like, in the A tier, because it didn't have the poster for Shang-Chi there. Javon Good said Civil War tops Avengers. Okay, I would say
I think Civil War is definitely a better Avengers movie than First Avengers.
I'd say so. I'd do that, and then I'd say that. Okay, so then A with that one, just put the people just imagine that Shang-Chi is after. I know it's before First Avenger, and then with the B. Or with the C, just imagine that Eternals is after Captain Marvel. Did you like Eternals more than Captain Marvel?
I think so, yeah.
Okay, so Eternals is before Captain Marvel. Captain Marvel's there, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I would say I liked Eternals more than Thor 2, Iron Man 2, Incredible Hulk. Black Widow, Captain Marvel. I think I would say I'd rather maybe watch those ones, maybe. Maybe. Yeah. All right. Yeah, so we'll come back updated when the Hawkeye show comes on, and then when Spider-Man comes on. So it'll be an ever-growing list here. So we worked it out. Yeah. Awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. What do you guys think of our tier list? How wrong do you think we are? Yeah. Right do you think we are?
Yeah. It took us almost 2 hours to tell us. Oh,
man. Wow, who knew that talking about 20 different movies makes a...
Yeah. All right. So real quick, Nick, Big Mouth, moving on from the MCU tier list. I'm going to discuss Big Mouth season 5. I didn't get a chance to see it, but Nick, you did. Let us know your thoughts on it, man.
All right. Big Mouth is one of the grossest animated shows I've ever seen. It's definitely in the vein of something like Drawn Together or something like kind of the epitome of these like raunchy comedies. But I think thematically it does it in a way that keeps it grounded in its characters. It keeps everybody with realistic character motivations and does really well with the metaphor of the monsters, of the human resources monsters, a lot of which are voiced by Nick Kroll. And in this season, we get introduced to the hate worms and the love bugs, who I think are voiced by Brandon Kyle Goodman and Quinta Brunson, who I think give fantastic performances, especially later in the season. And something that I think thematically, because each season it's kind of dealing with introducing a new kind of hormone monster. The second scene is in, it was very much dealing with the introduction of the Shame Wizard, who I think is one of the greatest side characters, voiced by David Thewlis. The third, it was you get introduced to the menopause banshee, I think. And season 4, you get Tito the Anxiety Mosquito, which is something that I think is a very fascinating depiction of anxiety and what that does to a person. And here you get the love bugs and the hate worms, and you get to see how those two emotions, taken to their absolute extremes, how they can warp a person's mind and how that can affect your life. I think this is... I still really like the show, but I think this is probably the weakest season because it goes through different cycles so fast. But I think this show, it's a show that the crowd that I think would benefit the most from watching this should be the ones that stay the fuck away from this. Like younger, like teenage kids, because this does bring up topics like anxiety and consent and puberty and dealing with what the hell that does to your body. And it culminates in, I think, probably the best season finale of the show, where I do not want to give it away, but it's definitely one of the biggest creative swings that this show takes. I love this show. I think you should absolutely check it out. I give this season a solid 8 out of 10. I do think there are drags kind of in the middle, especially with its like sixth or fifth and sixth episode.
Mm. So I haven't seen the show. I know some of the criticism of the show is dealing like it's a show about young children, but young children really shouldn't watch it.
It's a show about young children, but it's all voiced by grown adults. And I think they bring it up in the final episode of this show. This is mostly about the cast working through a lot of that shit that they did when they were kids.
Yeah. So, you know, because it being, you know, about puberty, about growing up, about, you know, that kind of that stage of development. So you think it's, you know, good for adults to watch it, you know, as, you know, because everybody's gone through that stage of puberty, and then they can, that's where the humor comes from, is this being, you know, being that age, you think?
Yeah, I think a lot of the humor comes from remembering the time you were at that age. And also some very clever, raunchy stuff that catches you off guard. Especially because I think the eighth episode is when they play around with like doing a puppet version of the characters.
Okay. So I've been hearing good things about it. I mean, it's on season five. I hear good things about it. I've been meaning to check it out. So I'll probably binge it maybe one day, get my own thoughts on it and watch it out. So that was Big Mouth. That was season five. Thank you, Nick. So since we're discussing TV anyway, I'm going to move on to Dexter, New Blood. Dexter, New Blood is Dexter Hall is Dexter Morgan. I'm sorry. Dexter Morgan is back. Everybody's favorite serial killer. You know what I mean?
Yeah. He heard people were talking a little too kindly you.
Yeah.
And Michael C. Hall just said, allow me to reintroduce myself.
Yeah. And I watched all the seasons of Dexter when it was on air. By the way, Joe, worse person, I think, than Dexter, I would say.
He is much worse than Dexter.
I would say.
Yeah, Dexter has no delusions about what kind of he is.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Like, Dexter knows who he is. You know, most definitely is not trying to fake himself out. Like, yeah, I know I'm sick. I know. But you know, hey, it is what it is. Can't change it, you know? And I watched all the seasons of Dexter when it was on Showtime. I followed it. Season four is absolutely amazing. John Lithgow, is great.
Season four is the absolute peak of that show. It's one of the greatest seasons of television. Introduces one of the greatest TV villains with John Lithgow as the Trinity Killer. And after that show, the head showrunner, Clyde Phillips, he left. So it pretty much fell onto Scott Buck to write and showrun the rest of the show. Yeah. So basically, I think it was somebody else before Scott Buck took over, because season five, I think it's weaker than four, but I think it's okay. After that, this show takes a left turn into goddamn shit Stainville.
Yeah. It just, like, if you watch the show, yeah, it just went completely off the rails. Storylines didn't make sense. All of a sudden, Deborah, she started to say she was in love with Dexter. Like, that just came out of nowhere.
It came out of nowhere. It's really weird considering that the actors, Jennifer Carpenter and Michael C. Hall, got married and divorced through the time that the show was on the air.
Yeah. So it's a lot of, I would love to be on that set. Like, wow, that tension must have been great. Oof. I mean, holy shit. But yeah, and they're coming back here. They're working together again. So if you haven't never seen Dexter, I'm going to get a little bit of spoilers for the show because, because it's
just pretend that the show ends at season four.
Yeah, pretty much. So with this season, it takes place after what we saw with the finale of Dexter, where you see him.
The finale. Spoilers for the finale of a show that went off the air more than 10 years.
Yeah.
Dexter, Deborah dies after getting shot by the newest killer that Dexter is chasing. He abandons his young son in the custody of another serial killer who's played by Yvonne Strahovski. And Dexter decides to abandon everybody and drive his boat headfirst into a hurricane.
And comes out, and now he's in the cabin all the way in Iron Lake, New York.
He fucked off, grew a beard, and became a lumberjack.
And the series kind of introduces you to his new life as Jim Lindsay. So this guy, he works at a gun shop, you know, in this small town, and he's, kind of permanently put on his human face, as he called it, in the show. And what's gone from the original show is, because the original show had this nice little opening when it showed like his morning routine, this nice little theme, which I listened to before. I was like, oh yeah, I remember this. That always would get you in the mood for the show. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, it's one of the greatest title sequences ever. If you were just watching the show cold and just seeing the opening, you know that something is wrong with this man. And I think this show, this first episode, it's the biggest departure from any of the previous seasons, because the show, it was narrated a lot by Michael C. Hall. You saw a lot more interaction with the character of Harry, who was played by James Remar as kind of his Jiminy Cricket. And here that role is taken up by Jennifer Carpenter.
Yeah, so that's kind of replaced there. Jennifer Carter comes in as kind of, like you said, his Jiminy Cricket in the situation before, was his adopted father, or actually it was his real father, wasn't it? Or no?
No, it was his adopted father.
Yeah, adopted father, yeah. He just had a relationship with his mother, that was all. He didn't actually, because she had already had a kid by the time he met her. Yeah. She already had him by the time he met her. So yeah, so, you know, that's kind of role was taken up here. So you see him, he's got a girlfriend, you know, who's a, you know, cop. You could say maybe, you know, trying to, you know, replace Deborah in a sense, you know what I mean? You could also say, I guess, kind of, you know, and he works at this gun shop, you know, and they say in the premiere episode here that he hasn't killed anybody since the show has basically been off the air, you know what I mean? Almost close to 10 years.
There's an addiction storyline with Dexter and his need to kill people. And I think in this first episode, it's essentially the story of an addict relapsing.
You know, because you see him, you know, he's out there in the woods, you know, he can't even kill a deer, you know what I mean? He's got the gun pointed out there.
I think thematically, the deer, it represents his guilt over his past life, the loss of his sister, and the abandonment of his son. And that was kind of the thing he was holding on to keep him from backsliding into killing people again. And then once it's taken away, he has no recourse anymore.
And you know, he's trying to, you know, trying to fit in, trying to do his best, you know, live this normal life, but there's just a motherfucker that just is pushing him. I mean, it's really just pushing him.
There is this stereotype Wall Street douchebag who is played, I think, excellently by this actor, Steve M. Robertson, who's playing a character named Matt Caldwell, who is a more exaggerated take on Jordan Belfort.
I think it's a little bit, you know, a little stereotypical in a way, you know what I mean? Douchebag, rich guy.
I would say stereotypical, but come on, we've all known or met people like this.
True. I mean, that is really who thinks, you know, he's better than everybody, you know, in a small town, you know, richer than everybody. And, you know, there is that one guy that's just constantly just pushing him. And, yeah, it's, you know, to just relapse and just to go back to revert back to his old ways. Also, you kind of see a situation here where there's another, like, kind of serial killer here that's, you know, kind of killing these women, making them disappear, kidnapping and killing women in the area, making them disappear. Like, there's numerous victims. So that kind of sets up, because the thing about the Dexter series is he would always hunt other killers. You know, he would always hunt other serial killers.
Yeah, his code, it was, I can only kill people that are other serial killers that have escaped the law.
Yeah, you know. And, you know, so because he was a blood spatter analyst when he was working for the Miami Police Department there. And so that's what he would do. He would kind of use that as his job there to kind of hunt other people who kind of escaped the law, you know, different killers, you know, gang members, drug dealers, you know, things like that of that nature. And so that kind of also, so this episode sets up the possibility that he may be also hunting another killer that is killing these women in this area. And I think that, you know, I think it's a good return, for the character.
Javon Good says, I still need to watch this, was not happy with that. Just off of this first episode, it's absolutely a return to form for Dexter. You have a lot of the original creators and showrunners coming back. Clyde Phillips, he is written and was a producer on all 9 of the episodes that are coming out for this show. A lot of the episodes are going to be directed by Marco Siega, who directed some of the best episodes of Dexter.
So I think, yeah, with that creative team coming back to do it, I think I have a lot more faith in this. And it's good
And they kicked Scott Buck the fuck out of the room. Thank God.
Yeah. So I have, you know, yeah, good faith for this. I think it's a good first episode. Yeah. I'm interested to see it continue. How many episodes is this supposed to be?
It's supposed to be 9 episodes. Ten. Excuse me. The first one just aired. It's airing Sundays on Showtime. And the finale date, on IMDb is listed for January 9th.
Yeah, so 10 episodes. So I think that's a good amount of episodes, you know, for this, you know. Yeah, what did you think about the first episode?
The first episode, I absolutely adored it. I loved seeing Michael C. Hall return. Michael C. Hall, this is probably one of his greatest performances on screen, and he, and this role fits him like a glove. He is wonderful in this. I liked a lot of the introductions of the side characters. I don't think any of them ever felt annoying in the same way that some of the side characters in the original run of the show did.
Mm.
I think his chemistry with his girlfriend, Julia Jones as the like chief of police here, I think that works really well. And there is an element here that is in the trailer of the return of his now grown son Harrison that I cannot wait to see what they do with that in the show.
Is he grown or is he just like a teenager?
Grown. They say it's 10 years after the events of original finale of Dexter, so he's probably like 16 or 15.
Yeah. Because I know he, like, because I'm kind of fuzzy on a little bit of the ending. So when he was with Rita and she died, I know he took care of her two kids because she had two kids of her own. Mm-hmm. And then what happened to those? Because those two kids went off with like their grandmother, right?
Yeah. Those two kids, they went off with their grandparents. They just left Dexter with Harrison.
Okay, yeah, with Harrison. Okay, with her kids. So yeah, I wonder if we'll see the return of Yvonne Strahovski. I wonder if we'll see the return of her. Is there any character you would? I actually liked her. You didn't like her? I thought she was actually kind of good.
Not really. The entire thing with her character is everybody who meets her falls in love.
Hmm.
Instead of letting any of her actions or anything that she does speak for her strength as a character.
Okay. Is there anybody you would like to see return from the older series come back? I think has a possibility to come back.
Maybe. I think if they did, they would probably just be in fall cameo roles. But for me, I think there's only one way that a show like this can end, and that's Dexter getting found out. And him getting found out of being a serial killer, of being Dexter Morgan, the Bay Harbor Butcher, and maybe do like quick cameos from some of the cop characters in from the original show. Like get David Zayas to come back briefly as Batista and see how that betrayal that he'll probably have.
Yeah, I see. What has the creator of Dexter done since Dexter?
Clyde Phillips? let's see. On his IMDb, he's a producer on stuff like Jackie. He's done Boomtown, but I think Dexter was his biggest claim to fame.
Javon Good said 10 years. He's assuming his kid came to find him. Yeah, his kid came to find him. Yeah, Dexter he was on the run, wasn't trying to pay that child support. you know what I mean? So, yeah. So, yeah, I think this is...
said, just going to fuck off and become a lumberjack.
Yeah. I think if you're a fan of Dexter and a fan of and you hated what happened at the end, I would say come back. I would say, come back, watch this episode, see what you feel about it. If you're not into it, then you can always just leave and do it that way.
If you don't like it, you can fuck off and become a lumberjack just like Dexter.
Yeah, you know what I mean? You can just, live that kind of life. I would thought, very solid episode, first episode. All right, so final thing that we're going to discuss is Cowboy Bebop. Which is the anime. I watched it. Nick did not. I was a big fan of this anime. I watched this when I was a teenager, when it used to come on Adult Swim. That was kind of the block of lineup that you used to watch there. And, this was a chance for me to go back and revisit it. I haven't seen this in years, over a decade. So what inspired me to watch it was because they are, doing the live action series of this, starring John Cho. And so I thought, since that's coming out, let me go back and watch the anime series, which is on Netflix right now, 26 episodes. You can watch the dub version right there. I've only ever seen the dub version, never seen the subbed. And great, it's one of the first, you know, probably one of the best dubs you can ever watch. Great voice cast from everybody involved. You know, Jet and Spike Spiegel, Faye, Ed, you know, all these kind of different characters, you know, great all down the line. And, you know, what the show kind of did was it was, you know, had this influence of neo-noir, westerns, you know, kind of had, you know, of course, the jazz music that also was involved. People loved the soundtrack. Every episode has an amazing, you know, soundtrack, amazing music in it. I should buy the music for this show because it's absolutely great.
Yeah, the soundtrack of the show is spectacular. It's done by this Japanese jazz funk band called Seatbelts.
And you know, it's absolutely amazing. The character of Spike Spiegel was, you know, somewhat inspired by the Lupin character from Lupin the Third, like the mm-hmm. looks, how, you know, kind of skinny he is. Also by Bruce Lee, because the way he fights with, you know, Bruce Lee's own personal fighting style, that was also kind of also another partial inspiration for the character. And you know, that they also bring in kind of other, you know, kind of characters like Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. There's a kind of like a Kareem Abdul-Jabbar-esque character here. Also, it's kind of good to back to watch all these different episodes since the live action show is gonna do a lot of these episodes. They're going to do a lot of these characters again. I know there was some controversy about when an actor they cast is like non-binary and he's playing a character mm-hmm. here. And I went back to that episode because I remember that character. And I remember I was like, yeah, I think that character did have breast and a penis at the time. And the character did. And the reason the character had breast. And I'm going to try to find the name of the character real quick. But the reason the character did was because the character had went to prison and they gave him like experimental drugs and that made the character grow breasts and things like that. And that's the reason why the character had that. But the character did identify as someone who was gay, as someone who's possibly asexual. That's possibly that. So that's part of the reason there too. And then when you watch the series back, there are characters who are gay. Like there's multiple characters mentioned having a girlfriend or a boyfriend. There's an episode where Faye, you know, where they're hunting down bounties and there's like where Faye points a gun, like a dude is in a bed with another dude and she just puts a gun in his mouth there. And I'm like, wow, I don't really remember this. From the series, and there used to be there's like dudes in drag here, you know, who are like who are sex workers, things like that. So I was like, oh wow, I don't really remember this. But so it was kind of fun, kind of seeing all this stuff, going back and watching this stuff, going back to the series. The aesthetic of the show is really great. You know, the look, you know, there's something about the way 90s anime animation looks, kind of that's very beautiful to look at. That kind of, you know, makes it look, and like how this Cowboy Bebop world, you see this universe that's built of kind of like, it's kind of dirty and gritty, this future, because nobody inhabits Earth. Like very few people, like most people left Earth because Earth became, you know, humans did, you know, what humans are doing to Earth right now, fucking it up. So, you know, people just left and people kind of all in the outer rims of the galaxy in outer space. And basically that's where you get people who are now like these modern day, you know, kind of cowboys and things like that who are doing these bounties, you know, like the old West. And they even call, you know, like Spike's character, you know, a cowboy, you know, things like that. They very much bring that in here. And I thought, you know, that was kind of very, very cool. Also bringing, you know, kind of the backstories with these characters are very good. Like Spike being this old kind of gangster, you know, and, you know, trying to leave that life with this woman that he was in love with, Julia, is a very big point in this. And trying to leave that life is also kind of very, very good. You also, you know, have the character Jed, who was like a retired police officer, and he's got a great backstory. And that's what I, you know, love about this. Like, you know, everybody's kind of got their own like fascinating story about them that they explore in each of the episodes. And that is very nice to watch, like, you know, him and, you know, he had, you know, a lot of situations where, you know, him being a cop and him falling in love with this woman and how, you know, that fell apart. Faye, you know, her whole story was like, she was cryogenically frozen. So, you know, like for 50 years, cause she was in an accident. So like, you know, large part of her life, you know, a lot of people she knew is either dead or gone. So she has to kind of start over in this future. And she's also in this massive amount of debt, you know, when she kind of wakes up. So that's the reason what pushes her to be a bounty hunter and how much she loves gambling, you know, trying to pay off debts and getting into more debt. I mean, she's almost like that character from Squid Game, you know, just constantly just kind of gambling over and over again, you know, I mean, getting excited and winning, then gambling more money, you know, just kind of getting more and more. And then you also have the character of Ed, who's like this hacker genius that they kind of discover in the 9th episode, who gets aboard. Also, this also show inspired my love for corgis. You know, love the little corgi Ayn, you know what I mean? Got him, who's also like a hyper-intelligent dog who can communicate with, you can see him communicate with other animals, you know, like a cow and everything like that. yeah, I mean, a lot of this, you know, I mean, the performances are really great. The story is very well handled. It's a very, like, this is a good anime. Like, if you want to get people into anime, people always would probably recommend this because it doesn't deal with anything crazy. It's simple. It's like bounty hunters in space, cowboys. It's like, okay, that's simple. That's not too crazy that you could wrap your mind around. That I think is also very interesting. And watching the show too, I also found very interesting was that these are kind of some of the worst bounty hunters, because like anytime they try to go and get a bounty, like something always happens. It's like they have a personal connection to the bounty, or they give it up. It's like, oh, okay, I can't do it. You know what I mean? Deep down, because I'm a good person and I can't do it.
So it's kind of like how the Mandalorian ended up being. It's like, yeah, I was supposed to be this bounty hunter, but god damn it. I bonded with the Mark. I let him go.
Yeah, I mean, this is a situation that happened, and they're always poor. They're always hungry. Like, they're so hungry that at times, like, their stomach, like, is, like, just growling all the time because they're absolutely so poor. And I'm like, okay, yeah. You know what I mean? You know, because they just don't have any money. Yeah, so I think, you know, that's kind of, you know, one of some of the great elements about the show as well. They also did a movie about Cowboy Bebop, which I also saw. Which was also very good as well. And this kind of is not a continue, because the end of the Cowboy Bebop series kind of leaves an open-ended kind of ending in a way. Like, the creator of it, Watanabe, said that he wanted to kind of leave it open-ended for anybody to kind of interpret their own ending of it. Kind of like the ending to Breaking Bad, but then that kind of, the ending got more defined because when they did the El Camino movie, which I didn't like at all when they did that, but whatever.
Wow, really?
Yeah, I didn't like the El Camino movie really all that much. Yeah, so with this, yeah, so they did a movie, you know, so it kind of takes, it's like just another adventure in kind of the Cowboy Bebop world here with the crew all involved. Yeah, and some great action scenes here between like Spike and like the main villain of the movie, which was very, very nice. Like the train sequence, I always remember as being like an awesome sequence from seeing the movie, and here it's also still holds up very well. You know, and one of the key parts of the series is the way he fights and everything like that. And Spike always kind of gets the shit beat out of him in a lot of episodes. He's like Mark from Invincible. I mean, he stays sometimes in bandages and, you know, in beds. Sometimes, I mean, he gets the shit beat out of him a lot. I mean, he can take a beating and a punch for sure. Man, I mean, I love this series. Absolutely. The music, the characters, the writing of it. I wish they would come back. They would do some more episodes with this, honestly, you know, anime wise, because I'm, you know, was absolutely in love with it. With the show, the live action show, I think it would have been better if they just kind of did more of like in the universe of Cowboy Bebop, like Fargo is in the universe there with Noah Hawley, the TV show that comes on FX. I think that would have been probably much better for it because it's a big universe. You know, you could have did a spinoff of maybe one of the characters from the Cowboy Bebop universe that you saw, because they did like one episode which was about like blaxploitation characters that they had, like a character that was kind of like the Pam Grier, the Foxy Brown character that was kind of like the Kareem Abdul-Jabbar character. There was one character who was like, he said he was like the great-great-grandson of like Shaft, you know what I mean, and stuff like that. So I thought, you know, maybe you could have did a spinoff about like kind of one of those characters that got introduced. Absolutely fantastic series. I mean, I probably not say anything you already haven't heard about the series. Many people listen to this.
You're echoing a lot of the points that I've heard about this. I keep finally sit down and watch Cowboy Bebop, but I don't know, I just keep not having the time for it.
Yeah. You know, each episode is like 23 minutes almost, you know what I mean? So it's a quick binge, you know, with the 26 episodes. Yeah, absolutely fantastic series. One of the things that, that inspired me to kind of watch anime and continue with it. I mean, it was the thing that got me into it. Like, I mean, you always love to hear the opening of it. That opening just gets you pumped. I mean, it's one of the best openings in all of anime. That is really great. So, yeah. This is, yeah, great. I would kind of give it, I'd say it's a 10 out of 10 for me. I don't really have any real issue with the show myself. I think it's, you know, absolutely amazing, you know, front to back. Love the music. Yeah, love everything about it. Yeah, great anime. Javon Good, he said my favorite episode. If I had to say my favorite episode, I would say the Jupiter Jazz part one, part two. I think that's a great episode. That's the episode where Faye, she meets the character that is from Vicious' past, because Vicious and this other character, who Vicious is the main kind of villain of the show, the main antagonist to Spike. You know, he fought in a war with another character, and he kind of comes into conflict with Vicious in that episode. And I think that's a great episode. Also, the finale, I think, is also a great episode as well. The finale is also a two-parter as well. And the different dynamics of how everybody works together on the ship, of how Faye and Spike have this, you know, antagonistic relationship, how they're kind of going back and forth, is very funny to watch. Jet kind of looks at kind of Spike, you can see like maybe like an older brother type relationship, because Jet is like 36 and Spike is 27 in this. You know what I mean? He's trying to stop him from being so, you know, bullheaded, so dumb at times. This is, yeah, really, really great series. Yeah, I love it a lot. We're going to head out of here. Long show. Good show. We're going to be...
Yeah, kind of making up for how short yesterday's stream was. We really didn't have much to talk about those movies.
Yeah, yesterday was... I don't think it even cracked an hour, did it?
It was barely broke through an hour.
Yeah, yesterday we talked about Finch, we talked about Clifford, we talked about Red Notice. I'm going to put those episodes up Sunday. I'm going to put those episodes up where people can watch them, and I'm going to probably, given the time, I'm probably release this soon, like Monday or Tuesday. Something like that. Next week, though, people, we're going to come back with you. We're going to come back and we're going to watch Ghostbusters. We're going to review that for you. Ghostbusters Afterlife. That's kind of the big movie. Is anything else coming out next week?
I think the live action Cowboy Bebop, but I'll have to double check on that.
Okay. Let me just do real quick. Yeah, I think
it's 10 more days till Resident Evil.
10 more days till Resident Evil. Okay, yeah. That's also...
Welcome to Raccoon City, a movie that I completely forgot was coming out.
Yeah, that movie, that's coming out November 24th, I think. The live action series coming out November 19th, so that's coming out this week. We're going to be reviewing that. We're going to be talking about. So, yes, it's that Ghostbusters Afterlife and the live action Cowboy Bebop series for now. That's what we'll get on the docket for now, and of course we'll let you know if anything else comes up. Alright, let's get out of here. Nick, where can people find you?
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Nick. Josh, where can they find the show?
Alright, so we're on all the social medias. We're on TikTok, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter at The Afternoon Tune. We are wherever you listen to podcasts, at The Afternoon Tune on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Anchor. You can check us out there. Of course, we are on YouTube at youtube.com, The Afternoon Tune. We're also on Twitch at twitch.tv/The Afternoon Tune. We're always going to be here. If you want to send us an email, we're at theafternoontune@gmail.com. Of course, and to all you people out there, hope you enjoyed the show. And don't forget to always stay tuned.
Stay tuned.
All right.